This audiobook was created using text-to-speech software, and was not read by a real person. Please keep in mind the limitations of the technology when it comes to pacing and pronunciation. Also, if you enjoy the audiobooks we create, please consider supporting the expense of our projects through our Patreon page. Those who do so have access to exclusive book series, are able to download the MP3 files for all books we create, and also have early access to our normal YouTube releases. For more details, please visit patreon.com/yjkaudiobooks. The link is also available in the video description below. Thank you for listening, and we hope you enjoy the story. Star Wars: The Jedi Academy Trilogy, Book 2, Dark Apprentice. Written by Kevin J. Anderson. Preview. While the New Republic debates what to do with the deadly Suncrusher weapon, the rogue Imperial Admiral Daala uses her fleet of Star Destroyers to attack peaceful planets, including the watery homeworld of Admiral Ackbar. But as the battle for one planet rages, an even greater danger emerges at Luke Skywalker's Jedi Academy. A brilliant student delves into the dark side of the Force, and unleashes an ancient evil so powerful, that even a Jedi Master may not be able to stop it. Chapter 1. The huge orange sphere of the gas planet Yavin heaved itself over the horizon of its fourth moon. Soft, misty light shone across the ever-stirring jungles and the ancient stone temples. Luke Skywalker used a Jedi refreshing technique to remove weariness from his body. He had slept soundly, but the future of the New Republic and the fate of the galaxy weighed heavily upon him. Luke stood atop the squared pyramid of the great temple that had been abandoned millennia before by the lost Masasi race. During the Alliance's early struggles against the Empire, they had built a secret base in the ruins, from which they had launched their desperate attack against the first Death Star. Now, 11 years after the rebels' departure, Luke had returned to the fourth moon of Yavin. Now he was a Jedi. A Jedi Master. He would be the first of a new generation, like those who had protected the Republic for 1,000 generations. The old Jedi Knights had been respected and powerful, until Darth Vader and the Emperor had hunted and slaughtered virtually all of them. Luke had received support from Mon Mothma, the New Republic's chief of state, to seek others who had a potential to use the Force, trainees who might become part of a new order of Jedi. Luke had managed to bring 12 students to his academy on Yavin 4, but he felt uncertain about the best way to train them. His own instruction by Obi-Wan and Yoda had been abbreviated, and Luke had since discovered facets of Jedi lore that made him realize just how much he still did not know. Even a great Jedi like Obi-Wan Kenobi had failed with his student and had let Anakin Skywalker become a monster named Darth Vader. Now Luke was expected to instruct others and make no mistakes. "Do or do not," Yoda had said, "there is no try." Luke stood on the smooth, cool stones of the rooftop and looked out across the awakening jungle, smelling the myriad sharp and sweet scents as the air warmed in the morning light. The spicy tang of blue-leaf shrub and the perfume of lush orchids drifted up to him. Luke closed his eyes and let his hands hang at his side, his fingers spread. He let his mind open and relax. He drew strength from the Force, touching ripples made by the life forms crowding the jungles below. With heightened senses he could hear the rustle of millions of leaves, twigs scraping, small animals scurrying through the underbrush. Letting out a yelp of pain and terror, a rodent thrashed and died as a predator crushed it in its jaws. Flying creatures sang mating songs to each other through the dense treetops. Large grazing mammals fed on leaves, tearing tender shoots from high branches or grubbing for fungi in the forest debris. A wide warm river, sapphire blue overlaid with muddy swirls of brown, flowed past the great temple, barely visible under the thick trees. The river bifurcated to send a tributary past the old rebel power generating station, which Luke and R2-D2 had repaired during their preparation for the Jedi Academy. Where the river sloshed around a submerged, half-rotted tree, Luke could sense a large aquatic predator lurking in the shadows, waiting for smaller fish-like creatures to swim by. The plants grew. The animals flourished. The moon awakened to a new day. Yavin 4 was alive, and Luke Skywalker felt energized. Listening intently, he heard two people approaching from far off in the dense foliage. They moved quietly, without speaking, but he could sense the change in the jungle as two of his Jedi candidates made a path through the undergrowth. Luke's introspective moment had ended. He smiled and decided to go down and meet them. As he turned to go back into the echoing stone halls of the temple, Luke looked up at the sky to see the streaking trails of a shuttlecraft descending through the humid atmosphere. He realized with a start that they were due for another delivery of supplies. Luke had been so focused on training new Jedi that he had lost touch with galactic politics. Upon seeing the shuttle, he felt a deep longing to know about Leia and Han and their children. He hoped the pilot would bring news. He shrugged down the hood of his brown Jedi cloak. The garment was too warm for the jungle humidity, but Luke had stopped noticing minor physical discomfort. He had walked across fire on Eol Sha and gone to the spice mines of Kessel, and he could not be bothered by a little perspiration. When the rebels had first set up their hidden base in the Masasi Temple, they had scoured the thick plant life from the chambers. Across the river stood another prominent temple, and according to orbital surveys, more structures lay buried under the implacable vegetation. But the Alliance had been far too wrapped up in its war against the Empire to bother with detailed archaeological inspections. The vanished race of temple builders remained as much a mystery now as when the rebels had first set foot on Yavin 4. The temple's flagstone corridors were uneven but remarkably unscathed after centuries of exposure to the elements. Luke took a turbolift from the pinnacle down to the third level, where other students slept or meditated in the early morning. As he stepped out of the turbolift, R2-D2 puttered out to greet him. The droid's wheels hummed along the bumpy flagstones, and his hemispherical head rotated back and forth, chittering at Luke. "Yes, R2, I saw the shuttle coming down. Would you go down to the clearing to meet it for me? Gantoris and Streen are returning from their sojourn in the jungle. I want to greet them and learn what they've found." R2 acknowledged with a bleep and trundled over to a stone ramp. Luke continued through the cool confines of the temple, smelling the mustiness of the enclosed air, the powdery tang of crumbling stones. Along the halls, some of the old Alliance banners still hung outside empty quarters. Luke's Jedi Academy was by no means luxurious, in fact, it was barely even comfortable. But he and his students had concerns that absorbed their energy far more than simple conveniences. Luke had not repaired all of the damage caused by time, but he had refurbished the glow panels, water systems, and food prep facilities the Alliance had installed. When he reached the ground level of the temple, the partially raised hangar bay doors stood like the dark slit of a mouth. Luke sensed echoes of the past inside the hangar bay, a faint residue of starfighter fuel and coolant, clinging dust and grease in the corners. He stepped outside to the jungle, blinking in the washed and faded sunlight as evaporating mists rose from the damp undergrowth. Luke's timing was perfect. As he walked through the lush foliage, he heard his two Jedi trainees approach. As an exercise in resourcefulness and as an opportunity for uninterrupted concentration, Luke sent his students in pairs into the wilderness. Alone, with no other abilities but their own, they worked on powers of concentration, sensing and studying other life forms, touching the Force. Luke raised his hand in greeting as the two stepped through feather ferns and thick blue-leaf shrubs. Tall, dark Gantoris parted heavy branches and came forward to meet Luke. His high forehead had been shaven clean of eyebrows, his skin looked chapped and weathered. Though Gantoris had calmly lived among geysers and lava flows on Eol Sha, he seemed startled to see the Jedi Master, but he covered his reaction instantly. On his hellish world, Gantoris had used an innate talent with the Force to keep a small group of forgotten colonists alive. Gantoris had had nightmares of a terrible, dark man, who would tempt him with power and then destroy him. At first he had thought Luke was that man, Luke, who appeared in his dark Jedi robe, striding through a geyser field to ask Gantoris to come to his academy. Gantoris had tested Luke by making him walk across lava and climb through geysers. Behind Gantoris came Streen, the second candidate Luke had found in his Jedi search. Streen had lived as a gas prospector in an abandoned floating city on the planet Bespin. Streen had been able to predict eruptions of valuable gases from deep within the cloud layers. Luke had tempted him with the ability to shut off the clamoring voices Streen heard in his head whenever he went to populated areas. As the trainees bowed, Luke clasped their hands. "Welcome back. Tell me what you've learned." "We found another Misasi temple," Streen said breathlessly, looking back and forth. His wispy pale hair was tangled, matted with flecks of vegetation. "Yes," Gantoris said. The man's ruddy face and his braided dark hair were smudged with sweat and dirt. "The new temple isn't as large as this one, but it seems more potent somehow. It's made of obsidian, sitting out in the middle of a shallow glassy lake, with a tall statue of a great lord. A site of great power," Streen said. "I felt the power too," Gantoris added. He straightened, tossing his thick braid behind him. "We should learn all we can about the Misasi race. They seem to have been very powerful, but they vanished entirely. What happened to them? Is there something we need to fear?" Luke nodded gravely. He, too, had sensed the power in the temples. The first time he had come to Yavin 4, Luke had been little more than a boy thrust headfirst into the rebellion against the Empire. He had barely realized the extent of the Force, in fact, he had learned of its existence only days before. But he returned to the jungle moon a Jedi Master, and he could sense many things that had been hidden to him before. He knew the dark power that Gantoris had detected, and although he told his students they must share what they learned, Luke felt that certain knowledge could be deadly. Darth Vader had discovered the wrong kind of knowledge. Luke could not dismiss the possibility that one of his students would be seduced by the dark side. Luke clapped his hands on their shoulders. "Come inside. Take a drink. A supply shuttle is landing, so let's go greet our guest." When they reached the cleared landing pad, R2-D2 waited next to the grid control kiosk, chittering coordinates to a descending X-23 Starworker space barge. Craning his neck, Luke watched the craft descend with a grinding whine of engines and a blast of jets. The Starworker barge looked like a trapezoidal cargo container with Incom sublight engines strapped on. The intrasystem craft had seen better days. Its gray metallic hull showed discolorations from blaster fire and countless pitted scabs from meteor encounters. But the engine sounded loud and strong as the landing gear kicked in. The space barge flashed its running lights around its belly, then settled down gently. Luke tried to squint through the tiny front port as a group of flying creatures in the treetops burst into flight, screeching and scolding the metal thing that had lumbered into their forest. Heavy plasteel support struts extended, locking to the ground with a hiss of hydraulic pressure. The bitter oil smell of exhaust hung in the humid air, mixing with the peppery and sweet scents of jungle flowers and leaves. The mechanical smell reminded Luke of the bustling metropolis of Imperial City, the governmental center of the New Republic. Though he had been at peace for months now on Yavin 4, Luke felt a tingle of sweat down his back. He could not let his guard slip for one second, he had a mission to do for the New Republic. This was not a vacation. The hull of the space barge continued to mutter to itself as it settled. With a coughing hiss, the rear cargo doors slid apart slowly as if two giants pushed them back one step at a time. Bluish-white light shone down on crates and boxes wrapped in storage nets or bolted to the walls, food, communications equipment, clothing, and amenities. Moving softly across the packed clearing, Gantoris and Streen came up beside him. Streen's eyes went wide with a sense of wonder, but Gantoris wore a puzzled, sour expression. His skin remained dark, as if in a constant angry blush. "Do we need these things, Master Skywalker?" Luke glanced at the contents. Judging from the material, the unnecessary material, included in the shipment, Leia herself must have compiled the cargo list. Exotic food synthesizers, comfortable clothes, heaters, humidity neutralizers, even a few hollow Ithorian wind chimes. "We'll make do," he said. A narrow ramp extended with a groan of pistons and rollers from the raised pilot compartment. The silhouette of a man appeared on the ramp, booted feet, wrinkled and padded flight suit, rounded helmet. He descended, yanking his white helmet off as his gloved hands covered the blue scooped arc symbol of the New Republic. The pilot shook his head, tossing short dark hair from side to side. "Wedge." Luke grinned and shouted. "Doesn't the New Republic have anything better for its generals to do? A delivery driver in space." Wedge Antilles stuffed his helmet under the padded orange sleeve of his flight suit and extended a hand to Luke. Luke embraced Wedge in the greeting of two friends who had not seen each other in far too long. "You've got to admit I'm qualified for the job," Wedge said. "Besides, I got tired of doing demolition work in the armpit of Imperial City, and before that I got tired of cleaning up wrecked spacecraft in orbit around Coruscant. I figured a delivery driver was better than a garbage man." Wedge flicked a glance over Luke's shoulder, and another smile dimpled his cheeks. Gantoris came forward from the cargo bay and gave Wedge a quick, almost brutal handshake as he locked eyes with the pilot. "General Antilles, have you any word from my people? I trust they have all been safely shuttled to their new home on Dantooine." "Yes, Gantoris, they're all settled in and doing fine. We drop-lifted an entire settlement of self-erecting living modules. We sent them programming units and agricultural droids so they could establish a viable colony right away. Dantooine is a very mild planet, plenty of animals to hunt and native vegetation to eat. Trust me, they'll be much more comfortable than they were on Eol Shah." Gantoris nodded solemnly. "That I do not doubt." His glittering eyes looked past Wedge to the treetops. Orange light from the rising gas giant made his eyes flicker like the lava pools he had made Luke walk across on Eol Shah. "Gantoris, Streen, please start unloading the supplies," Luke said. "I don't think you'll have trouble lifting the crates with a little nudge from the Force. Consider it a test. R2, please call Karana Team Dorsk 81 from their quarters to help." Streen and Gantoris moved to the corrugated ramp from the loading bay. R2-D2 hummed across the landing grid and disappeared into the shadowy hangar of the Great Temple in search of the other Jedi candidates. Luke clapped his friend on the shoulder. "I'm starving for news, Wedge. I hope you brought some gossip with you." Wedge raised his eyebrows. His narrow chin and soft features made him look more youthful than Luke. They had been through a lot together. Wedge had flown beside Luke on his triumphant run down the Death Star corridor, had assisted in the defense of Echo Base on the ice planet Hoth, and had fought against the second Death Star over Endor. "Gossip?" Wedge asked, laughing. "That doesn't sound like something that would interest a Jedi Master." "You got me there, Wedge. How are Leia and Han? How is Mon Mothma? How are things on Coruscant? When is Han going to bring Kip Duran to my training center? That boy had enormous potential, and I want to start working with him." Wedge shook his head at the volley of questions. "Kip will be here, Luke, don't worry. He spent most of his life in the spice mines of Kessel, and he's only been out a month. Han's trying to show the kid how to live a little first." Luke remembered the dark-haired teen Han had rescued from the black spice mines. When Luke had used a Jedi testing technique to see if Kip had potential to use the Force, the boy's response had knocked Luke across the room. In his entire Jedi search, Luke had never encountered such power. "And what about Leia?" Wedge considered, and Luke appreciated that he didn't just answer with a simple, "Of course everything's fine." "She seems to be spending more and more time with her duties as Minister of State. Mon Mothma has been handing off a lot of important responsibilities to Leia while she herself stays in her private chambers and rules from a distance. It's got a lot of people disturbed." That behavior seemed highly unusual for the strong, compassionate ruler Luke remembered. "And how is Leia handling it?" He longed to know a thousand things at once, wishing he could be in the thick of it all again, while another part of him preferred the peace of Yavin 4. Wedge sat on the edge of the sloping ramp. He propped one leg next to a support strut, then balanced his helmet on his knee. Leia's doing a wonderful job, but she's trying to do too much, if you ask me. Even with baby Anakin still in hiding, she does have the twins to watch over now. 3PO helps, but Jason and Jaina are still only 2.5 years old. It's more than a full-time job, and Leia is getting exhausted. She could come here for a rest, Luke suggested. Have her bring the twins, since I need to get them started on basic Jedi skills. I'm sure Leia would love to come here, Wedge said. They turned and watched as Streen and Gantoris emerged from the barge carrying tall crates. The two Jedi candidates walked smoothly, carrying loads that seemed impossible, and Wedge's eyes widened at the impressive feats of strength. I had to have labor droids put those boxes on board. I couldn't budge one myself. Then my students must be showing some progress. Luke nodded. What about you, Wedge? You going to be a delivery driver the rest of your career? Wedge smiled, then with a flick of his wrist he tossed the helmet up the ramp and into the open cockpit. It clacked and thumped across the floor. No. In fact, I came here because I have a new assignment, and I won't get a chance to see you again for some time. The New Republic Council feels that Dr. Quizux may be in danger from espionage. Admiral Daala is still out there somewhere with her fleet of Imperial Star Destroyers, and any time now I expect her to start blasting planets at random with hit-and-run strikes. She may try to get Qui back. Luke nodded gravely. Quizux had been the top scientist in the Imperial Research Facility from which Han Solo had escaped, with Qui's help. If Admiral Daala doesn't want Dr. Zux back, I'm sure someone else will. Yeah, Wedge said, that's why I've been assigned as her personal bodyguard and escort. In the meantime, the Council still hasn't decided what to do with the Suncrusher weapon that Han captured. Wedge sighed. That's just scratching the surface of everything going on back on Coruscant. Luke stared at Gantoris and Streen as they continued to unload the cargo bay, marching across the clearing to deposit their crates in the empty, cool hangar. R2-D2 rattled out of the temple, leading two other students. Sounds like you need the new Jedi Knights more than ever, Luke said. Wedge agreed emphatically. More than you can know. Chapter 2. Fidgeting from the long voyage in the expanded B-Wing fighter, Leia Organa Solo rode in silence beside Admiral Ackbar. The two of them sat in the cramped, metallic-smelling cockpit as the ship plunged through hyperspace. Being Minister of State kept Leia on the move, shuttling from diplomatic event to ambassadorial reception to political emergency. Dutifully, she hopped across the galaxy, putting out fires and helping Mon Mothma hold together a fragile alliance in the vacuum left by the fall of the Empire. Leia had already reviewed the background holos of the planet Vortex dozens of times, but she could not keep her mind on the upcoming Concert of the Winds. Diplomatic duties took her away far too often, and she used quiet moments to think about her husband Han, her twin children Jason and Jaina. It had been too long since she had held her youngest baby, Anakin, who remained isolated and protected on the secret planet Anoth. It seemed that whenever Leia tried to spend a week, a day, even an hour alone with her family, something interrupted. She seethed inside each time, unable to show her feelings because she had to wear a calm political mask. In her younger days, Leia had devoted her life to the rebellion. She had worked behind the scenes as a princess of Alderaan, as Senator Bail Organa's daughter, she had fought against Darth Vader and the Emperor, and more recently against Grand Admiral Thrawn. Now, though, she felt torn between her duties as Minister of State and her duties as Han Solo's wife and as mother to three children. She had allowed the New Republic to come first. This time. Again. Beside her in the cockpit, Admiral Ackbar moved his amphibious hands fluidly as he manipulated several control levers. Dropping out of hyperspace now, he said in his gravelly voice. The salmon-colored alien seemed perfectly comfortable in his white uniform. Ackbar swiveled his gigantic glassy eyes from side to side, as if to take in every detail of his craft. Through the hours of their journey, Leia had not seen him fidget once. He and the other inhabitants of the watery world Calamari had suffered much under the Empire's iron grip. They had learned how to be quiet, yet listen to every detail, how to make their own decisions, and how to act upon them. Working as a loyal member of the rebellion, Ackbar himself had been instrumental in developing the B-Wing class of starfighters that had taken such a huge toll on the Imperial TIE fighters. As Leia watched him pilot the stretched-out, cumbersome-looking fighter, Ackbar seemed an integral part of the gangly craft that appeared to be all wings and turbolaser turrets mounted around a dual cockpit. Ackbar's crew of fish-like Calamarians, led by his chief starship mechanic, Turpfen, had expanded the former one-man craft into Ackbar's personal diplomatic shuttle, adding a single passenger seat. Through the curved dome of the cockpit windows, Leia watched as multicolored knots of hyperspace evaporated into a star-strewn panorama. The sublight engines kicked in, and the B-Wing streaked toward the planet Vortex. Leia's dress uniform felt damp and clingy, and she tried to adjust the folds of slick fabric to make herself more comfortable. As Ackbar concentrated on the approach to Vortex, Leia pulled out her pocket holopad, laying the flat silvery plate on her lap. "Beautiful," she said, peering out the viewport to the planet beneath them. The blue and metallic gray ball hung alone in space, moonless. Its atmosphere showed complex embroideries of cloud banks and storm systems, racing spirals of clouds that swirled in horrendous gales. Leia remembered her astronomical briefings about Vortex. The sharp tilt of the planet's axis produced severe seasonal changes. At the onset of winter, a vast polar cap formed rapidly from gases that froze out of the atmosphere. The sudden drop in pressure caused immense air currents, like a great flood going down a drain. Clouds and vapor streamed southward in a battering ram to fill the empty zone where the atmosphere had solidified. The Vors, hollow-boned humanoids with a rack of lacy wings on their backs, went to ground during storm season, taking shelter in half-buried hummock dwellings. To celebrate the winds, though, the Vors had established a cultural festival renowned throughout the galaxy. Deciding to review the details one more time before they landed and the diplomatic reception began, Leia touched the icons etched into the synthetic marble frame of her datapad. It would not do for the New Republic's Minister of State to make a political faux pas. A translucent image shimmered and grew out of the silvery screen in a miniaturized projection of the Cathedral of Winds. Defying the hurricane gales that thrashed through their atmosphere, the Vors had built a tall ethereal structure that had resisted the fierce storm winds for centuries. Delicate and incredibly intricate, the Cathedral of Winds rose like a castle made of eggshell-thin crystal. Thousands of passageways wound through hollow chambers and turrets and spires. Sunlight glittered on the structure, reflecting the rippling fields of wind-blown grasses that sprawled across the surrounding plains. At the beginning of storm season, gusts of wind blew through thousands of different-sized openings in the honeycombed walls, whipping up a reverberating, mournful music through pipes of various diameters. The wind music was never the same twice, and the Vors allowed their cathedral to play only once each year. During the concert, thousands of Vors flew into or climbed through the spires and windpipes, opening and closing air passages to mold the music into a sculpture, a work of art created by the weather systems of the storm planet and the Vor people. On the holopad, Leia skimmed to the next files. The music of the winds had not been heard for decades, not since Senator Palpatine had announced his new order and declared himself emperor. Objecting to the excesses of the Empire, the Vors had sealed the holes in their cathedral and refused to let the music play for anyone. But this season the Vors had invited representatives from the New Republic to come and listen. Ackbar opened a calm channel and pushed his fish-like face closer to the voice pickup. Leia watched the bristly feelers around his mouth jiggle as he spoke. "Vortex Cathedral landing pad, this is Admiral Ackbar. We are in orbit and approaching your position." A Vor voice like two dry twigs rattling together crackled back over the speaker. "New Republic shuttle, we are transmitting landing coordinates that take into account wind shear and storm systems along your descent. Our atmospheric turbulence is quite unpredictable and dangerous. Please follow precisely. Understood. Ackbar settled back into his seat, rubbing broad shoulder blades against the ridged back of the chair. He pulled several black restraint strands across his chest.
You'd better strap in, Leia, Ackbar said. It's going to be a bumpy ride.
Leia switched off her holopad and tucked it beside her seat. She secured herself, feeling confined by the webbing, and took a deep breath of the stale recycled air. The faintest fishy undertone suggested Calamarian anxiety. Staring ahead, Ackbar took his B-wing into the swirling atmosphere of Vortex, straight toward the storm systems. Ackbar knew that humans could not read expressions on broad Calamarian faces. He hoped Leia did not realize how uneasy he felt flying through such hellish weather patterns. Leia did not know that Ackbar had volunteered to take the mission because he trusted no other person to pilot someone as important as the Minister of State, and he trusted no other vehicle more than his personal B-wing fighter. He turned both of his brown eyes forward to watch the approaching cloud layers. The ship cut through the outer layers of atmosphere, zooming into buffeting turbulence. The sharp wings of the starfighter sliced the air, curling wind in a rippling wake. The wing edges glowed cherry red from the screaming descent. Ackbar gripped the controls with his flipper hands, concentrating on fast reactions, split-second decisions, making sure everything worked just right. In this landing there would be no room for error. He cocked his right eye down to scan the landing coordinates the Vor technician had transmitted. The craft began to rattle and jitter. His stomach lurched as a sudden updraft knocked them several hundred meters higher and then let them fall in a deep plunge until he managed to wrestle control back. Blurry fists of high-rising clouds pummeled the transparent steel viewports, leaving trails of condensed moisture that fanned out and evaporated. Ackbar tracked from side to side across the panels with his left eye, verifying the readouts. No red lights. His right eye cocked back to catch a glimpse of Leia sitting rigid and silent, held in place by black restraint cords. Her dark eyes seemed almost as wide as a Mon Calamarian's, but her lips were pressed together in a thin white line. She seemed afraid, but afraid to show it, trusting in his ability. Leia said no word to distract him. The B-wing headed down in a spiral, skirting an immense cyclonic disturbance. The wind hooked the rattling wings of the fighter, knocking the craft from side to side. Ackbar deployed the secondary aileron struts in an attempt to regain stability and retracted the laser cannon turrets to minimize wind resistance. New Republic shuttle, we show you off course, the brittle twig voice of the Vor controller came over the speaker, muffled by the roaring wind. Please advise. Ackbar turned his left eye to double-check the coordinate display, and saw that the starfighter had indeed veered off course. Calm and focused, he tried to force the craft back onto the appropriate vector. He couldn't believe he had gone so far astray, unless he had misread the coordinates in the first place. As he yanked the B-wing toward a wall of spiraling clouds, a blast of gale force winds hammered them into a roll and slammed Ackbar against his pilot seat. The fighter spun end over end, battered by the wild storm. Leia let out a small scream before clamping her mouth shut. Ackbar hauled with all his strength upon the levers, firing stabilizer jets in a counterclockwise maneuver to counteract the spin. The B-wing responded, finally slowing its crazed descent. Ackbar looked up to see himself surrounded by a whirlwind of mist. He had no idea which direction was up or down. He accordioned out the craft's set of perpendicular wings and locked them into a more stable cruising position. His craft responded sluggishly, but the cockpit panels told him that the wings were in place. New Republic shuttle, please respond. The Vor did not sound at all concerned. Ackbar finally got the B-wing upright and flying again, but found he had missed his coordinates once more. He angled back into them as easily as he could. His mouth felt desiccated as he checked the altitude panels and saw with alarm how far the ship had dropped. The metal hull plates smoked and glowed orange from tearing through the atmosphere. Lightning slashed on all sides. Blue balls of discharge electricity flared from the tips of the wings. His readout scrambled with racing curls of static, then came back on again.
The cockpit power systems dimmed, then brightened as reserve power kicked in. Ackbar risked another glance at Leia and saw her fighting wide-eyed fear and helplessness. He knew she was a woman of action and would do anything to help him out, but there was nothing she could do. If he had to, Ackbar could eject her to safety, but he did not dare risk losing his B-wing yet. He could still pull off a desperate but intact landing. Suddenly, the clouds peeled away like a wet rag ripped from his eyes. The wind-whipped plains of Vortex spread out below, furred with golden brown and purple grasses. The grasslands rippled as the wind combed invisible fingers through the blades. Concentric circles of bunker-like Vor shelters surrounded the center of their civilization. He heard Leia gasp in a deep wonder that sliced through even her terror. The enormous cathedral of winds glinted with light and roiling shadows as clouds marched overhead. The high lacy structure seemed far too delicate to withstand the storms. Winged creatures swarmed up and down the sides of the fluted chambers, opening passages for the wind to blow through and create the famous music. Faintly distant, he could hear the lilting, eerie notes. "New Republic shuttle, you are on the wrong course. This is an emergency. You must abort your landing." With a shock, Ackbar saw that the displayed coordinates had changed again. The B-Wing did not respond as he fought the controls. The Cathedral of Winds grew larger every second. Cocking an eye to look through the upper rim of the domed viewport, Ackbar saw that one of the perpendicular wings had jammed at a severe angle, yielding maximum wind resistance. The angled wing slapped against the turbulence and jerked the starfighter to the left. His cockpit panels insisted that both wings had deployed properly, yet his own vision told him otherwise. Ackbar jabbed the controls again, trying to straighten the wing, to regain control. The bottom half of his body felt cold and tingly as he channeled reserves of energy into his mind and his hands on the control levers. "Something is very wrong here," he said. Leia stared out the viewport. "We're heading straight for the cathedral." One of the aileron struts buckled and snapped from the plasteel hull, dragging power cables as it tore free. Sparks flew, and more hull plates ripped up. Ackbar strangled an outcry. Suddenly the control lights flickered and dimmed. He heard the grinding hum as his main cockpit panels went dead. He hit the second auxiliary backup he had personally designed into the B-Wing. "I don't understand it," Ackbar said, his voice guttural in the confines of the cockpit. "This ship was just reconditioned. My own Calamarian mechanics were the only ones who touched it." "New Republic shuttle," the voice on the radio insisted. On the crystalline cathedral of winds, multicolored Vors scrambled down the sides, fleeing as they saw the craft hurtling toward them. Some of the creatures took flight, while others stared. Thousands of them were packed into the immense glassy structure. Ackbar hauled the controls to the right, to the left, anything to make the craft swerve, but nothing responded. All the power had died. He couldn't raise or lower the ship's wings. He was a large deadweight falling straight toward the cathedral. Desperately he hit the full battery reserves, knowing they could do nothing for the mechanical subsystems, but at least he could lock in a full power crash shield around the B-Wing. And before that, he could break Leia free to safety. "I'm sorry, Leia," Ackbar said. "Tell them that I am sorry." He punched a button on the control panel that cracked open the right side of the cockpit, splitting the hull and blasting free the tacked-on passenger seat. As it shot Leia into the claw-like winds, Ackbar heard the wind screech at him through the open cockpit. The crash shield hummed as he hurtled toward the great crystalline structure. The fighter's engine smoldered and smoked. Ackbar stared straight ahead until the end, never blinking his huge Calamarian eyes. Leia found herself flying through the air. The blast of the ejection seat had knocked the breath out of her. She couldn't even shout as the wind caught and spun her chair. The seat's safety repulsor lifts held her like a gentle hand and slowly lowered her toward the whip-like strands of pale-hued grasses below. She looked up to see Ackbar's B-Wing shuttle in the last instant before it crashed. The starfighter smoked and whined as it plunged like a metal filing toward a powerful magnet. In a frozen moment she heard the loud, mournful fluting of winds whistling through thousands of crystalline chambers. The breeze picked up with a gust, making the music sound like a sudden gasp of terror. The winged Vors scrambled and attempted to flee, but most could not move quickly enough. Ackbar's B-Wing plowed into the lower levels of the Cathedral of Winds like a meteor. The booming impact detonated the crystalline towers into a hail of razor-edged spears that flew in all directions. The sound of tinkling glass, the roar of sharp broken pieces, the shriek of the wind, the screams of the slashed Vors, all combined into the most agonizing sound Leia had ever heard. The entire glass-like structure seemed to take forever to collapse. Tower after tower fell inward. The winds kept blowing, drawing somber notes from the hollow columns, changing pitch. The music became a thinner and thinner wail, until only a handful of intact wind tubes were left lying on their sides in the glassy rubble. As Leia wept with great sobs that seemed to tear her apart, the automatic escape chair gently drifted to the ground, and settled in the whispering grasses. Chapter 3. The polar regions of Coruscant reminded Han Solo of the ice planet Hoth, with one crucial difference. Han was here by choice with his young friend Kip Duran for a vacation while Leia went off with Admiral Ackbar on yet another diplomatic mission. Han stood atop the crumpled blue-white ice cliffs, feeling warm in his insulated charcoal-gray parka and red heater gloves. The ever-present auroras in the purplish skies sent rainbow curtains flickering and refracting off the ice. He drew in a deep breath of crackling cold air that seemed to curl his nostril hairs. He turned to Kip beside him. "About ready to go, kid?" For the fifth time the dark-haired 18-year-old bent over to adjust the fastenings on his turbo skis. Almost, Kip said. Han leaned forward to peer down the steep turbo ski run of rippled ice, feeling a lump form in his throat but unwilling to show it. Blue and white glaciers shone in dim light from the months-long twilight. Below, ice-boring machines had chewed deep tunnels into the thick ice caps, other excavators had chopped broad terraces on the cliffs as they mined centuries-old snowpack, melting it with fusion furnaces to be delivered via titanic water pipelines to the dense metropolitan areas in the temperate zones. "You really think I can do this?" Kip said, straightening and gripping his deflector poles. Han laughed. "Kid, if you can pilot us single-handed through a black hole cluster, I think you can handle a turbo ski slope on the most civilized planet in the galaxy." Kip looked at Han with a smile in his dark eyes. The boy reminded Han of a young Luke Skywalker. Ever since Han had rescued Kip from his slavery in the spice mines of Kessel, the young man had clung to him. After years of wrongful imperial imprisonment, Kip had missed the best years of his life. Han vowed to make up for that. "Come on, kid," he said, leaning forward and igniting the motors of his turbo skis. With thickly gloved hands Han held on to the deflector poles and flicked them on. He felt the cushioning repulsor field emanating from each point, making the poles bob in the air to keep his balance. "You're on," Kip said, and fired up his own skis. But not the kiddie slope. He turned from the wide ice pathway and pointed instead to a side run that branched off over several treacherous ledges, across the scabby ice of a rotten glacier, and finally over a frozen waterfall to a receiving and rescue area. Winking red laser beacons clearly marked the dangerous path. "No way, Kip. It's much too..." But Kip launched himself forward and blasted down the slope. "Hey!" Han said. He felt sick in the pit of his stomach, sure he would have to pick up Kip's broken body somewhere along the path. But now he had no choice but to blast after the boy. "Kid, this is really a stupid thing to do." Crystals of powdery snow sprayed behind Kip's turbo skis as he bent forward, touching the ground at occasional intervals with his deflector poles. He kept his balance like an expert, intuitively knowing what to do. After only a second of the thundering descent, Han realized that Kip might be more likely to survive this ride than he was. As Han rocketed down the slope, The snow and ice hissed beneath him like a jet of compressed air. Han hit a frozen outcropping that sent him flying, and he somersaulted through the air, flailing with his deflector poles. Stabilizer jets on his belt righted him just in time as he slammed into the snow again. He continued down the slope with the speed of a stampeding bantha. He squinted behind ice goggles, concentrating intensely on keeping himself upright. The landscape seemed too sharp, every razor-edged drift of snow, the glittering sheared-off face of ice, as if every single detail might be his last. Kip let out a loud whoop of delight as he slewed left onto the dangerous offshoot turbo ski path. The whoop echoed three times around the sharp-edged cliffs. Han began cursing the young man's recklessness, then experienced a sudden inner warmth as he realized he had expected little else from Kip. Making the best of it, Han let out an answering whoop of his own and turned to follow. Red laser beacons flared, warning and guiding the foolish turbo skiers along the path. The rippled surface whispered beneath the soft cushioning fields of his turbo skis. Ahead, the icy roadway seemed foreshortened and continued at a different elevation. Han realized the danger an instant before he reached the precipice. Cliff. Kip bent low, as if he had simply become another component of his turbo skis. He tucked his deflector poles close to his sides, then fired up the rear jets of his skis. He rocketed over the edge of the cliff, arcing down in a long smooth curve to the resumption of the trail. Barely in time, Han activated his own jets and launched himself over empty space. His stomach dropped even faster than gravity could tug him down. Wind ruffled the edges of his parka hood. In front of him, Kip landed smoothly without so much as a wobble and shot downslope. Han had time to take only one gulping breath as the plateau of ice rushed up to meet his turbo skis with a loud crack. He gripped his deflector poles, desperate to maintain his balance. A powdery ribbon of drifted snow curled across their path. Kip jammed down with his deflector poles, hopping up into the air and cleanly missing the drift, but Han plowed straight through. Snow flew into his goggles, blinding him. He wobbled and jabbed from side to side with his poles. He managed to swipe a gloved hand across his goggles just in time to swerve left and avoid smashing into a monolithic ice outcropping. Before he had recovered his balance, Han launched over a yawning chasm in the rotten glacier that fell out beneath him. For a timeless instant he stared down at a drop of about 1,000,000 kilometers, and then he landed on the far side. Behind him, he heard a whump, as a block of age-old snow lost its precarious grip on the wall and plunged into the crevasse. Ahead, Kip encountered a blocky, rubble-strewn glacier field. More widely spaced now, the laser beacons seemed to give up and let foolhardy turbo skiers choose their own path. Kip wobbled as he struck hummocks of ice and snow. He raised the repulsor field to skim higher over the surface. As the crusty glacier grew rougher, clogged with grainy blown snow, Han muttered complaints and curses through gritted teeth. He kept his balance somehow, but Kip had lost ground. Han found himself breathing the boy's wake, pushing closer and faster, and suddenly the race meant something to him again. Afterward, while sitting around in a cantina and swapping stories, he would somehow convince himself that the whole thing had been a great deal of fun. Feeling a bit of the recklessness he had just cursed Kip for, Han pulsed the jets, lunging forward in an adrenaline-filled burst of speed that brought him side by side with Kip. A snowfield sprawled in front of them, sparkling white and unsullied by other turbo ski tracks, even though it had not snowed for more than a month in this arid frigid climate, demonstrating exactly how few people had been foolish enough to attempt the dangerous path. Ahead, the roped-off receiving and rescue area lay like a sanctuary. Communications gear, warming huts, powered down medical droids that could be reactivated at a moment's notice, and an old hot beverage shop that had long since gone out of business. Home free, they had made it. Kip glanced sideways at him, his dark eyes crinkled at the corners. He crouched down and blasted his skis at full power. Han hunched over to decrease his air resistance. Pristine snow flew around him, hissing in his ears. The line of laser beacons switched off like metallic eyes blinking shut. Han had no time to wonder about it before the smooth blanket of snow ahead bulged, then sloughed inward. A crunching, grinding sound accompanied the straining of massive engines. Gouts of steam erupted from the collapsed snowfield as the glowing red nose of a mechanical thermal borer thrust into the open air. The screw-shaped tip continued to turn as it chewed its way out of the solid ice. "Look out!" Han yelled, but Kip had already veered off to the left side, leaning hard on one deflector pole and jabbing at the air with his other. Han punched his stabilizing jets and streaked to the right as the mammoth ice processing machine chewed the opening of its tunnel wider, clutching the walls with clawed tractor treads. Han skimmed past the gaping pit, feeling a blast of hot steam across his cheeks. His goggles fogged again, but he found his way to the steep ice waterfall, the final obstacle before the finish line. The edge of the precipice flowed with long tendrils of icicles like dangling cables that had built up over centuries during the brief spring thaws. Kip launched himself over the edge of the frozen river, igniting both ski jets. Han did the same, tucking his poles against his ribs, watching the packed snow fly up to strike the bottoms of his skis with a loud slap that echoed along the ice fields in unison with the sound of Kip's landing. They both charged forward, then slewed to a stop in front of the cluster of prefab huts. Kip peeled down the hood of his parka and started laughing. Han held on to his deflector poles, feeling his body tremble with relief and an overdose of excitement. Then he, too, began chuckling. "That was really stupid, kid," Han managed at last. "Oh." Kip shrugged. "Who was stupid enough to follow me? After the spice mines of Kessel, I wouldn't consider a little turboski slope too dangerous. Hey, maybe we could ask 3PO to tell us the odds of successfully negotiating that slope when we get back." Han shook his head and gave a lopsided grin. "I'm not interested in odds. We did it. That's what counts." Kip stared across the frozen distance. His eyes seemed to follow the arrow-straight lines of non-reflective water conduits ringed with pressure joints and pumping stations. "I'm glad we've had so much fun, Han," he said, staring into something only he seemed to see. "I've done a lifetime's worth of healing since you rescued me." Han felt uncomfortable at the thick emotion he heard in Kip's voice. He tried to lighten the mood. "Well, kid, you had as much to do with our escape as I did." Kip didn't seem to hear. "I've been thinking about what Luke Skywalker said when he found my ability to use the Force. I only know a little bit about it, but it seems to be calling me. I could do a huge service to the New Republic. The Empire ruined my life and destroyed my family. I wouldn't mind getting a chance to strike back." Han swallowed, knowing what the boy was trying to say. "So you think you're ready to go study with Luke and the other Jedi trainees?" Kip nodded. "I'd rather stay here and have fun for the rest of my life, but—" Han said in a soft voice, "you deserve it, you know." But Kip shook his head. "I think it's time I start taking myself seriously. If I do have this gift of using the Force, I can't let it go to waste." Han gripped the young man's shoulder and squeezed hard, feeling Kip's rangy frame through his bulky gloves. "I'll see that you get a good flight to Yavin 4. The whirring hum of repulsor lifts broke the quiet moment. Han looked up as a messenger droid approached, streaking like a chromium projectile over the ice fields. The droid arrowed straight for them. Han muttered, "If that's a representative from the Turbo Ski Resort, I'm going to file a complaint about that ice mining machine. We could have been killed." But as the messenger droid hovered over them, lowering itself to Han's eye level, it snapped open a scanning panel and spoke in a genderless monotone. "General Solo, please confirm identification. Voice match will be sufficient." Han groaned. "Ah, I'm on vacation. I don't want to bother with any diplomatic mess right now." "Voice match confirmed." "Thank you," the droid said. "Prepare to receive encoded message." The droid hovered as it projected a holographic image onto the clean snow. Han recognized the auburn-haired figure of Mon Mothma. He straightened in surprise, the chief of state rarely communicated with him directly. Han, Mon Mothma said in a quiet, troubled voice. He noticed immediately that she had called him by his first name instead of his more formal rank. A fist of sudden dread clenched his stomach. I'm sending you this message because there has been an accident. Admiral Ackbar's shuttle crashed on the planet Vortex. Leia was with him, but she's safe and unharmed. The Admiral ejected her to safety before his ship flew out of control, directly into a large cultural center. Admiral Ackbar managed to power up his crash shields, but the entire structure was destroyed. So far, at least 358 Vors are confirmed dead in the wreckage. This is a tragic day for us, Han. Come home to Imperial City. I think Leia might need you as soon as she returns. Mon Mothma's image wavered, then dissolved into staticky snowflakes that faded in the air. The messenger droid said, "Thank you. Here is your receipt." It spat out a tiny blue chit that landed in a puff of snow at Han's feet. Han stared as the droid turned and streaked back toward the base camp. He squashed the blue chit into the snow with the base of his turboski. He felt sick. The excitement he had just experienced, all the joy with Kip, had evaporated, leaving only a leaden dread inside him. Come on, Kip. Let's go. C-3PO thought that if his fine motor control had allowed it, his entire golden body would be chattering with cold. His internal thermal units were no match for the frozen polar regions of Coruscant. He was a protocol droid, fluent in over 6 million forms of communication. He was able to perform an incredible number of diverse tasks, all of which seemed more appealing at the moment than babysitting a pair of wild 2.5-year-olds who saw him as their plaything. 3PO had taken the twins to the snowplay area at the bottom of the ice slopes, where they could ride tame tauntauns. Little Jason and his sister Jaina seemed to enjoy the spitting, cumbersome creatures, and the Umgullion rancher who had brought the furry animals to Coruscant seemed delighted to have the business. Afterward, 3PO had stoically endured as the twins insisted on making a snow droid of him, packing layers of snow around his shiny body. He still felt ice crystals caked inside his joints. As he enhanced the output from his optical sensors, 3PO thought that his golden alloy had taken on a decidedly bluish tinge from the low temperature. On a sledding slope, the twins spun around, giggling and shrieking as they bounced against padded restraints in a child's snow skimmer. 3PO waited for them at the bottom, then began the long trudge back up the hill so the children could do it all over again. He felt like a low-capacity labor droid with too little computing power to understand the drudgery of its own existence. "Oh, how I wish Master Solo would get back soon," he said. At the top of the ramp, he secured Jason and Jaina snugly into their seats. In tandem, they looked up at him with rosy-cheeked faces. Humans claimed to find the winter chill exhilarating. 3PO wished he had outfitted himself with more efficient low-temperature lubricants. "Now, you children, be careful on the ride down," he said. "I shall meet you at the bottom and bring you back up." He paused. Again. He launched the children in the spinning snow skimmer. Jason and Jaina laughed and squealed as feathers of snow sprayed down the slope. 3PO began to move with a rapid gait down the long ramp. When he reached the bottom, the twins were already attempting to unstrap themselves. Jaina had managed to disconnect one buckle, though the attendant at the equipment rental station had assured 3PO that the restraints were utterly childproof. "Children, leave that alone," he said. He refastened Jaina's restraint and switched on the hover field beneath the snow skimmer. He grasped the handles and began to climb back up the slope to the launching platform. When he reached the top, both twins shouted, again, in unison, as if their minds were linked. 3PO decided it was time to lecture the children about overindulgence in enjoyment, but before he could formulate a speech with the appropriate levels of sternness and vocabulary, a crowded shuttle skimmer arrived. Han Solo emerged, pulling back the hood of his gray parka and balancing his turbo skis on his left shoulder. Kip Duran followed him out of the transport. 3PO raised a golden arm. "Over here," he said. "Master Solo, over here." "Daddy," Jaina said. Jason echoed her a fraction of a second later. Thank heavens, 3PO said, and started to unfasten the restraints. Get ready to go, Han said as he marched forward, his expression unaccountably troubled. 3PO reached forward, about to begin his litany of complaints, but Han dropped the bulky turbo skis into the droid's arms. Master Solo, is something wrong? 3PO tried to balance the heavy skis. Sorry to cut your vacation short, kids, but we have to get back home, Han said, ignoring the droid. 3PO straightened. I'm very glad to hear that, sir. I don't mean to complain, but I was not designed for temperature extremes. He felt an impact against the back of his head as a large lump of snow splattered him. Oh, he said, raising his arms in alarm, barely managing to keep hold of the skis. Master Solo, I must protest, he said. Jason and Jaina giggled as they each picked up another snowball to throw at the droid. Han turned to the twins. Stop playing with 3PO, you two. We have to get back home. Down in the repair bays of the revamped Imperial Palace on Coruscant, Lando Calrissian couldn't imagine how Chewbacca managed to cram his enormous furry body inside the Falcon's narrow maintenance crawlway. Standing in the corridor, Lando saw the Wookiee as a tangle of brown fur wedged between the emergency power generator, the acceleration compensator, and the anti-concussion field generator. Chewbacca let out a yowl as he dropped a hydrospanner. The tool bounced and fell with a series of ricocheting clangs until it landed in a completely inaccessible spot. The Wookiee snarled and then let out a yelp as he banged his shaggy head on a coolant pipe. No, no, Chewbacca. Lando said, brushing back his sleek cape and sticking his arm into the maintenance crawlway. He tried to point toward the circuitry. That goes here, and this goes there. Chewbacca grumbled back, disagreeing. Look, Chewie, I know this ship like the back of my hand, too. I owned her for quite a few years, you know. Chewbacca made a string of ululating sounds that echoed inside the enclosed chamber. All right, have it your way. I can work the access hatches on the outside hull. I'll retrieve your hydrospanner. Who knows what other junk we'll find there. Lando turned and made his way to the entry ramp, stomping down into the cacophony of shouted requests and engine noises in the starship mechanic bay. The air smelled oily and stifling, tainted with gaseous coolants and exhaust fumes from small diplomatic shuttles to large freighters. Human and alien engineers worked on their ships. Stubby Ugnaughts clambered inside access hatches and chattered at each other, requesting tools and diagrams for fixing troublesome engines. Admiral Ackbar's carefully picked crew of Calamarian starship mechanics oversaw special modifications to small vessels in the New Republic fleet. Terpfen, Ackbar's chief mechanic, wandered from ship to ship, status board in hand, verifying requested repairs and scrutinizing the work with his glassy fish eyes. Lando pried open the access hatch on the Falcon's outer hull. The hydrospanner clattered out and fell into his outstretched hands, along with burned-out cyber fuses, a discarded hyperdrive shunt, and the wrapper from a package of dehydrated food. Got it, Chewbacca, he shouted. The Wookiee's answer was muffled inside the cramped access hatch. Lando looked at the scorch marks along the Falcon's battered hull. The ship seemed to be one massive collection of patches and repairs. He ran a calloused hand along the hull, caressing the metal. Hey! What are you doing to my ship? Lando jerked his hand away from the Falcon and looked around guiltily to see Han Solo approaching. Chewbacca bellowed a greeting from the maintenance crawlway. Han's face reflected a thunderstorm of bad moods as he strode across the debris-strewn floor of the mechanic bay. I need my ship right now. Is she ready to fly? Han said. Lando put his hands at his side. I was just making some repairs and modifications, old buddy. What's the problem? Who told you you could make any modifications? Han looked unaccountably angry. Chewie, we've got to fly right away. Why did you let this clown mess around with my engines? Wait a minute, Han. This used to be my ship, you know, Lando said, not knowing what had provoked such anger in his friend. Besides, who rescued this ship from Kessel? Who saved your tail from the Imperial fleet? C-3PO hastened stiffly into the mechanic bay. Ah, greetings, General Calrissian, he said. Lando ignored the droid. I lost the Lady Luck rescuing your ship. I'd think that deserves a little gratitude, don't you? In fact, since I sacrificed my own ship to save your hide, I thought maybe you'd be grateful enough to give me back the Falcon.
Oh, my. 3PO said.
That is an idea that might warrant some consideration, Master Solo.
Shut up, 3PO, Han said without glancing in the droid's direction.
Looks like you've got an attitude problem, Han, Lando said with a grin he knew would annoy his friend. But Han had stepped over the bounds of common courtesy with his snappish accusations, and Lando had no intention of letting him get away with it.
Han looked ready to explode.
Lando couldn't figure out what was bothering him.
My problem is you've been sabotaging my ship.
I don't ever want you touching her again, do you understand?
Get your own ship.
Seems to me that with the 1,000,000 credit reward you got at the blob races on Umgo, you could buy just about any ship you want and stop messing around with mine.
An excellent idea, sir, 3PO added helpfully.
With that amount of money, General Calrissian, you could indeed buy a fine ship.
Be quiet, 3PO, Lando said, putting his hands on his hips.
I don't want to buy another ship, old buddy.
He stressed the last two words with thick sarcasm.
If I can't have the Lady Luck, I want the Falcon.
Your wife is the Minister of State, Han.
You can have the government provide you with any sort of transport you want, why not get yourself a new fighter right from the Calamarian shipyards?
I'm certain that could be arranged, sir, 3PO agreed.
Shut up, 3PO, Han said again, keeping his eyes on Lando.
I don't want any old ship.
The Falcon is mine.
Lando glowered at Han.
You won her from me in a sabacc game, and to tell you the truth, old buddy, I've always suspected you cheated in that game.
Han became livid, backing away.
You're accusing me of cheating?
I've been called a scoundrel before, but never a cheat.
In fact, it seems to me, he said in a low, threatening voice, that you won the Falcon yourself in a sabacc game before I came along.
Didn't you also win the Cloud City Tabana gas mines from the former Baron Administrator in a sabacc game?
What could you possibly have used as collateral for a bet like that?
You're a dirty no-good swindler, Lando.
Admit it.
And you're a pirate.
Lando said, stalking forward, his fists bunched at his side. He had made his reputation as an expert gambler.
Chewbacca growled from within the Falcon, making loud clangs and thumps as he extricated himself from the cramped passage.
He stumbled down the entry ramp and stood gripping the piston supports.
As Han and Lando closed to within striking distance, 3PO wriggled in between them.
Excuse me, sirs, but might I make a suggestion?
If indeed you both won the ship in a sabacc game, and if you are contesting the results, could you perhaps simply play another game of sabacc to settle this issue once and for all?
3PO turned his glowing optical sensors first at Lando, then at Han.
I just came down here to get my ship, Han said, but now you've made it into a point of honor.
Lando glared at Han without flinching.
I can beat you any day of the week, Han Solo.
Not this day, Han said, lowering his voice even further.
But not just sabacc.
We'll make it random sabacc.
Lando raised his eyebrows, but met Han's gaze stare for stare.
Who's going to keep track of the plays?
Han jerked his chin to the side.
We'll use 3PO as our modulator.
Goldenrod doesn't have enough brains to cheat.
But, sir, I really don't have the programming to, 3PO said.
Han and Lando snapped in unison, shut up, 3PO.
All right, Han, Lando said, let's do it before you lose your nerve.
You're going to lose more than nerve before this game is over, Han said.
As Lando set up the cards and the sabacc table,
Han Solo ushered the last of the off-duty bureaucrats toward the door of the small lounge.
Out. Come on. We need to use this place for a while.
They grumbled and objected in a variety of languages, but Han assisted them through the entryway with gentle shoves.
File a complaint with the New Republic. Then he closed and sealed the door, turning to Lando.
You ready yet?
This was far different from the stuffy, smoke-filled parlors where he used to play Sabacc, such as the underground game where he had once won a planet for Leia in an attempt to buy her affections. At the Sabacc table, Lando spread out a handful of rectangular cards with crystalline screens sandwiched between metal layers.
Ready when you are, buddy.
But he looked uneasy.
Han, we don't really have to do this.
Han sniffed the air, frowning at the cloying smells of deodorizing mists and ambassadorial perfumes.
Yes, I do.
Leia's been in an accident on one of her diplomatic missions, and I want to escort her back home, not some hospital ship.
Leia's hurt?
Lando said, standing up in surprise.
So that's what has been bothering you.
Forget it, take the ship.
I was just kidding anyway.
We'll do this some other time.
No.
We do it now, or you'll never be off my case.
3PO, get in here.
What's taking so long?
Han said.
The golden droid scooted in from the backroom computer station, looking flustered, as usual.
I'm here, Master Solo. I was just reviewing the Sabacc rules programming.
Han punched his selections into the console of the bartender droid, smiling as he selected a fruity, prissy drink for Lando, complete with a blue tropical flower as a garnish, and a spiced ale for himself. He sat down, slid the drink across the surface to Lando, and sipped his ale.
Lando took a swallow of the mixture, winced, and forced a smile.
Thanks, Han.
Should I deal?
He held the Sabacc cards in his hand, leaning over the table's projecting field.
Not yet.
Han held up a hand.
3PO, double-check to make sure those card surfaces are completely randomized.
But, sir, surely.
Just do it.
We want to make sure nobody gets an unfair advantage, don't we, old buddy?
Lando managed to retain his forced smile as he handed the deck to 3PO, who ran the cards through a scrambler at the side of the table.
They are completely mixed, sir.
3PO meticulously dealt five of the flat metallic cards each to Lando and to Han.
As you know, this is random Sabacc, a combination of variant forms of the game, 3PO said, as if reciting the programming he had just uploaded.
There are five different sets of rules, shifted by chance, and changed at random time intervals as determined by the computer's random generator, that's me.
We know the rules.
Han growled, but he wasn't so certain.
And we also know the stakes.
Lando's deep, flinty eyes met his across the table.
Winner takes the Falcon.
Loser takes Coruscant public transit from now on.
Very well, sirs, 3PO said, activate your cards.
The first player to reach a score of 100 points will be declared the winner.
Our first round will be played according to.
He paused briefly as his randomizing function made a selection from the scrambled list of rules.
Cloud City Casino Alternate Rules.
Han stared at the images appearing on his cards as his mind raced to remember how Cloud City Casino rules differed from the Bespin standard form of the game. He stared at a mixed-up assortment of the four suits in Sabacc: sabers, coins, flasks, and staves, with various positive and negative scores on each.
Each player may select one and only one of his cards for a spin change, and then we tally to see who comes closest to a score of positive or negative 23, or 0.
Han scanned his cards, concentrating, but found no set that would add up to an appropriate tally.
Lando wore a broad smile, but Lando always carried such an expression when he gambled.
Han took a sip of his bitter spiced ale, swallowed hard, and chose a card.
Ready?
He raised his eyes to look at Lando.
Lando pushed the small scrambler button on the bottom left corner of a card.
Han did the same, watching the image of the 8 of coins flicker and reform into a 12 of flasks. Together with a 9 of flasks in his hand, he added to 21. Not great. But when he saw Lando scowl at his own new card, he hoped it would be good enough.
21, Han said, slapping his cards on the table.
18, Lando answered with a scowl.
You get the difference.
Change of rules.
Time has elapsed.
3PO said.
3 points in favor of Master Solo.
Next round is by Empress Tata preferred system.
Han looked at his new hand of cards, delighted to see a firm straight, but, if he remembered right, under Empress Tata rules the players swapped one card at random, and when Lando reached over to pluck a card from the right side, Han hoped to replace it with a commander of sabers, but the hand failed.
Lando won the round and came out with a small lead, but before they could tally the scores, 3PO chimed in with another change of rules.
This time, scored under the Bespin standard system, Lando's lead doubled.
Han cursed to himself as he stared at a chaotic mess in the next hand, not knowing what to bid, what to throw away.
Before he made his decision, though, the random clock in 3PO's electronic brain forced him to call another rules change.
Corellian gambit this time, sirs.
Han hooped in delight, for under the new rules the suits fit together with a completely different pattern.
Gotcha, he cried, laying down his hand.
Lando grumbled, showing a wild card that, while valuable only moments before, now cost him 14 points under the new scoring system.
Han crept ahead over the next several hands, then lost ground when rules changed back to Cloud City Casino style, which deemed all wild cards forfeit.
Han reached forward to snatch one of Lando's cards, just as Lando selected one of his cards to change at random.
They both froze.
3PO, tell us again which rules we're playing under.
New time interval anyway, the golden droid said.
Change to Bespin standard.
No, wait, new time interval again.
Back to Empress Tata preferred.
Han and Lando looked at their new cards again, minds whirling in confusion.
Han took another sip of his spiced ale, and Lando drained his fruity concoction with a grimace.
At the bottom the bright-colored flower had begun to sprout writhing roots that crawled on the bottom of his glass.
3PO, tell us the scores one more time, Lando said.
Calculating for the last rules change, sirs, the total is 93 points for Master Solo and 87 for General Calrissian.
Han and Lando glared at each other.
Last hand, buddy, Han said.
Enjoy your remaining few seconds of ownership, Han, Lando said.
Corellian Gambit rules, last hand special case, 3PO announced.
Han felt his head pounding, trying to remember what happened in the last hand of the Corellian Gambit.
Then he saw Lando locking in the denomination of only one of his cards, making ready to place his hand into the flux field in the center of the sabacc table.
Han studied his high-ranking face cards, balance and moderation, either of which would nudge him over the total score of 100.
He pushed the retainer button on balance, for 11 points, then thrust the rest of his hand into the flux field.
Han and Lando leaned over, staring in suspense as the images on the cards swirled and changed, flickering from one value to another in a blur until they stabilized, one by one.
Lando stared at low-denomination numeric cards, nothing at all spectacular, while Han got the best deal he had seen throughout the entire game.
All face cards, Demise, Endurance, the Star, and the Queen of Air and Darkness, along with the balance card he had kept.
His score handily passed the goal, leaving Lando in the dust.
He cheered at the same instant 3PO declared another change of rules.
Han glared at the golden droid, waiting.
This hand will be scored under the Ecclesis Fig variation, 3PO said.
Han and Lando looked at each other, mouthing the words.
What is the Fig variation?
In the final round the scores of all odd-numbered face cards are subtracted instead of added to the final score.
This means, Master Solo, that while you gain 10 points for Endurance, and the Queen of Air and Darkness, you forfeit a total of 41 for Balance, the Star, and Demise.
3PO paused.
I'm afraid you lose, sir.
General Calrissian gains 16 points for a total score of 103, while you are left with a final score of 62. Han blinked in shock at his half-empty glass of spiced ale as Lando pounded the tabletop in triumph.
Good game, Han. Now go on off to fetch Leia.
Want me to come with you?
Han kept staring at the table, at his ale, at anything but Lando.
He felt hollow inside.
Not only had he learned of Leia's tragedy today, but he had also lost the ship he had owned for more than a decade.
Take her, she's yours, Han mumbled.
He finally looked up to meet Lando's eyes.
Come on, Han.
You're distraught.
You never should have made the bet in the first place.
Just.
No, the Falcon is yours, Lando.
I'm not a cheat, and I made the deal going into the game.
Han stood, turning his back on Lando, leaving the rest of his ale untouched.
3PO, authorize a change of registration for the Falcon.
And you'd better get in touch with Central Transportation Control.
Arrange a diplomatic transport for Leia.
I won't be picking her up after all.
Lando shifted uncomfortably.
I'll take good care of her, Han.
Not a scratch.
Without another word, Han went to the door of the lounge, unsealed it, and walked out into the echoing halls.
Chapter 4.
With black-gloved hands clasped behind her back, Admiral Daala stood at attention on the bridge of the Imperial Star Destroyer Gorgon. In front of the bridge viewport, brilliant gases illuminated by a knot of blue giant stars turned the Cauldron Nebula into a spectacular light show. Beside her in parking formation hung the Basilisk and the Manticore. The ionized gases played havoc with ship sensors, making the nebula a perfect hiding place for her three fully armed battleships. Daala heard a tentative boot step behind her, and turned to face Commander Kratos.
Yes, Commander.
As she moved, her olive-gray uniform clung like a second skin, while her mane of coppery hair trailed behind her like the tail of a comet. Kratos snapped off a perfect salute and remained standing one step below her observation platform.
Admiral, he said, as of 0900 hours we have completed our assessment of the losses suffered during our battle at Kessel.
Daala formed her lips into a tight, emotionless line.
Kratos was a short man, recruited into the Imperial Navy from an occupation force on one of the conscripted planets.
He had dark hair trimmed to regulation length, wide watery eyes set under beetling brows, and a jutting chin that hung below almost non-existent lips.
The best part of Kratos, though, Daala thought, was that he always followed orders.
He had been trained well in the Imperial Military Academy on Kerida.
Give me the breakdown, Commander, Daala said.
Kratos did not blink as he rattled off the numbers from memory.
Together, we lost a total of 3 TIE squadrons, and of course all hands and resources on board the Hydra.
Daala felt a cold stab of anger at the mention of her wrecked battleship.
Kratos must have seen something in her expression, because he flinched, though he did not move aside.
The Hydra, Daala's 4th Star Destroyer, had been torn apart in one of the Maw Cluster's black holes.
It had been Daala's first significant loss in combat, 1/4 of her destructive capability wiped out by Han Solo and the traitorous scientist Quizux, who had stolen the Suncrusher superweapon and fled the Empire's closely guarded Maw installation.
However, Kratos continued. His voice quavered the smallest bit, then he straightened.
40 TIE fighters from the Hydra did manage to reach safety inside the other Star Destroyers, which makes up somewhat for the other losses.
Daala's Star Destroyers had emerged from the Maw Cluster, expecting to engulf and obliterate Han Solo, but her ships had run headlong into Kessel's ragtag fleet like frenzied battle dogs.
Though her Star Destroyers had defeated nearly 2/3 of Kessel's ships, the Basilisk had suffered severe damage and had to be linked with the Gorgon's navicomputers for escape to a secret location in the Cauldron Nebula.
What is the status of repairs to the Basilisk? She said.
Kratos clicked his heels smartly as if pleased to give good news.
3 of the 4 damaged turbolaser cannons have been refurbished and are now operational.
We expect to finish repairs on the 4th battery within the next 2 days.
Armored spacetroopers have completed work on the breached external hull. Decks 7 through 9 are airtight again, and we are currently replenishing the atmosphere. The damaged flight control circuitry has been rerouted, and the navicomp and targeting consoles are now fully operational. He drew in a deep breath. In short, Admiral, I believe our entire fleet is ready for battle again. Daala leaned closer to the observation window, curling her long fingers around the simulated wood of the railing. She tried unsuccessfully to stop a smile from creeping across her lips. The metallic smell of the air comforted her. She had lived on the Gorgon for over a decade now. The air had been reprocessed and replenished until pungent organic odors had been scoured away, leaving only sterile smells, the tang of metal and lubricating oils, the reassuring scent of pressed Imperial Navy uniforms and polished stormtrooper armor. "If I might ask a question, Admiral," Kratos said, glancing around to see the other personnel at their stations, every head turned studiously away from the conversation, pretending not to listen. Daala raised her eyebrows, waiting for him to continue. "With the information we gained from interrogating Han Solo, and with transmissions we've received, we know that the Emperor is no longer alive, that Darth Vader and Grand Moff Tarkin are also dead, and that the Empire has fragmented into civil war." Kratos hesitated. Daala spoke for him. "You are wondering, Commander, who our Commander-in-Chief is?" Kratos nodded vigorously. "Grand Admiral Thrawn has been killed, as has Warlord Zinj. We know of several commanders still fighting over the remnants of the Empire, but they seem more interested in destroying each other than in battling the rebellion. If I may make a suggestion. The Imperial Military Academy on Carita still appears to be stable and loyal, with a great many weapons at their disposal. Perhaps it would be best to." "I don't think so," Daala said sharply, turning from him to smother her scowl. She had been trained and trounced in the harsh military academy on Carita. Because she was female, Daala had been passed over for promotion after promotion, she had been given the worst assignments. She had been brutalized. And that had only increased her drive to succeed. Finally, she had created a false identity for herself through Carita's vast computer networks and used that identity in combat simulation rooms. She had won repeatedly, creating breakthrough tactics that had been adopted by many of the Imperial Army's ground assault forces. After Moff Tarkin had discovered Daala's true identity and realized her talent, he had secretly whisked her away, using his new authority as Grand Moff of the Outer Rim Territories. He had promoted her to the rank of Admiral, as far as she knew, the only female Admiral in the entire Imperial fleet. Yet because of the Emperor's own prejudices against women and non-human races, Tarkin had kept the truth about his new admiral a secret. Daala and Tarkin had become lovers, and to keep her from coming to the Emperor's attention, he had given her command of 4 Star Destroyers assigned to guard the super-secret think tank inside the Black Hole Cluster. But now that she had come out with her battleships, ready to devastate any planet loyal to the rebellion, Daala could not conceive of handing over that authority to her former persecutors on Carita. She took a deep breath again and faced Commander Kratos. He stood without moving, still waiting for her response. Around the bridge, other crew members looked up from their stations, but when Daala glanced at them, they quickly found other things to do. "Since the faction seem to have forgotten that our true enemy is the rebellion, I think we will set an example for them. We must focus their attention on the appropriate enemy, the rebels who killed Grand Moff Tarkin, who destroyed the Death Star, who murdered the Emperor. Since Grand Admiral Thrawn was the only person in the Imperial fleet with a rank higher than my own, I must assume that my rank is now at least as high as any of the pretenders." Kratos's eyes widened, but Daala shook her head. Her long hair swirled like flickering flames. "No, Commander, I have no intention of putting in my bid for what is left of the Empire. That's not a job I would relish. We'll leave that to the petty dictators. I just want to cause damage. Lots of it." Her lips curled in a snarl, and her voice grew husky. "I think our best chance is to rely on hit-and-run tactics, guerrilla warfare. We have 3 Star Destroyers.
That's enough to wipe out the civilizations on any number of worlds. We must hit fast and run fast. We will continue to pound the rebels for as long as we can." She glanced around the bridge to see that all personnel stood staring at her, some with wide eyes and gaping mouths, others grinning. Her crew had been bottled up for so long in the maw, ready to fight but denied any chance at action because they were forced to guard the group of prima donna weapon scientists. Daala glanced out at the Cauldron Nebula, saw the bright lights of other star systems piercing the haze of ionized gas. Many targets waited out there. She turned to the navigator's station. "Lieutenant, I want you to plot a course for the last known shipping lanes closest to our position." "Yes, Admiral," the lieutenant said, practically leaping toward his station. "Inform all personnel on the three ships," Daala said. A bold grin lit her face, she felt as if her blood had become molten copper. Her green eyes seemed to sparkle with laser bolts ready to be fired on unsuspecting prey. The fight was about to begin. "Let's go hunting," Daala said, and a spontaneous cheer erupted from the bridge crew. Deep in space, the pack of Imperial Star Destroyers waited, sensors alert and scanning for the ripples of approaching ships. They hung at a hyperspace node on the far end of the Corellian trade spine, where all ships bound for a node or Bespin or other planets along the line would drop out of hyperspace to recalibrate their course and set off on a new vector. Daala paced the Gorgon's bridge, keeping her gaze moving, watching her personnel as they waited. Her scrutiny kept them on edge, nervous, intent on performing flawlessly. She was proud of her crew. She felt confident that they could wrench a proud victory from the rebel scum. One of the lieutenants straightened at his sensor console. "Admiral. Fluctuations indicate a ship arriving in hyperspace. Tracking, it's coming through." Daala snapped commands. "Full alert. Instruct Basilisk and Manticore to power up their turbolaser batteries." Commander Kratos whirled from his station to delegate tasks. The intense alarm signal hooped through the decks of the Star Destroyer. Stormtroopers rushed to their posts, armor and boots clattering. "Gunners," Daala shouted through the intercom, "target to disable only. We must take the ship." "Here it comes," said the lieutenant. Daala spun to stare at the black emptiness of space, at the stars hanging motionless in complex patterns. A ripple appeared, like a scratch on black painted glass, and a mid-sized ship broke through into normal space and hung at a pre-programmed halt for navigational recalibration. Daala smiled, trying to imagine the expression on the captain's face as he suddenly found himself blockaded by three Imperial-class Star Destroyers. "A Corellian corvette, Admiral," Kratos said, as if Daala could not identify it herself. She glanced at the distinctive hammerhead shape of the bridge section and the bank of 12 enormous hyperdrive and sublight rocket motors glowing blue-white with exhaust. "They're the most common galactic transports. Might just be merchants." "What does that matter?" Daala said. "Prepare to fire. Let's test the Basilisk's repaired turbolaser batteries." "Admiral, the captain of the corvette is signaling us," the comm officer called. "Ignore it. Basilisk, open fire. Two surgical shots. Take out the rear hyperdrive units." Daala watched, feeling the electric thrill of command. Two blinding green arrows lanced out. The first bolt spattered and diffused against the corvette's increased shields, but the second blast punched through the weakened area and crippled the rocket engines. The corvette rocked in space, then slowly spun like a dead rodent on a wire. Red-yellow glow diffused from a ruptured power core. The three Star Destroyers loomed over the crippled ship. "The corvette's captain is signaling surrender," the comm officer said. Daala felt a brief twinge of disappointment but brought it under control. She could not allow herself to make stupid mistakes. She had already been overeager in pursuing Han Solo and the stolen Suncrusher, and that zealousness had caused her to lose the Hydra. Commander Kratos stepped behind her, lowering his voice. "What if this ship is not part of the Rebel Alliance?
Many smugglers also use Corellian corvettes.
A point well taken, Daala said.
Long ago Tarkin had impressed upon her that a good commander always listened to the opinions and suggestions of her trusted officers.
If the captain has connections with a smuggling network rather than the rebellion, then perhaps we can put him to work for us.
We could hire some spies, saboteurs.
Kratos nodded at the suggestion.
Engage a tractor beam, Daala said.
Open the lower bay doors, and we'll draw the corvette into our hangar.
Daala toggled the narrow beam comm system by her station, and an image of an Imperial Army general rose from the hollow dais.
His form flickered blue at the fringes from transmission distortion.
Daala bent over the image, like a giant contemplating a toy.
General Odosk, prepare your boarding party.
Have you briefed your troops?
Yes, Admiral, came the filtered voice.
We know what to do.
Daala whisked his image into thin sparkles of static.
It would be fitting to let survivors from the Hydra be the boarding party of their first captured ship.
The crippled corvette, still leaking thermal emissions from its breached power core, rose on invisible strings of the Gorgon's tractor beam.
The lower bay of the Star Destroyer slid open like the jaws of an enormous carnivore.
The comm officer spoke again.
Admiral, the captain of the corvette continues to ask for instructions.
She sounds rather distraught.
Daala snapped around.
She?
The corvette has a female captain.
It's a female voice, Admiral.
Daala tapped her fingers together, pondering the new information.
Women seem to have a much easier time at gaining command in the Rebel Alliance, but the extra burden of brutal struggle had made Daala stronger.
Keep her in suspense.
Capture complete, Admiral, Commander Kratos said.
The corvette offered no resistance.
Boarding parties are ready.
Close the hangar bay doors, Daala said.
Send a slicer team to drain the prisoner's computer core for information.
We need maps, history tapes.
We have too much to learn.
Didn't you just order General Odosk and his special crew to board the ship?
Kratos said.
Daala frowned sharply at him.
They have other orders.
You follow yours.
Yes, Admiral, Kratos said in a small voice.
Bring the captain of the corvette to the interrogation chambers.
We may need to encourage a bit of truthfulness.
Kratos nodded and walked briskly off the bridge.
The door of the grim interrogation room sighed open with a discouraging hiss.
When Daala entered, she was disappointed to see the captured captain, a short, mouse-faced Celestian with thick rubbery jowls hanging around a weak chin.
His great glassy eyes, pitch dark and glittering, reminded her of the black holes in the Maw Cluster.
The Celestian captain jabbered in a panic, his lips wet with foaming drool.
Beside him marched an old model chrome protocol droid that served as his translator.
The droid moved arms and legs with humming, ratcheting motivators as if its computer brain was so scrambled it could no longer control all of its systems at once.
The droid spoke in a brusque female voice.
Admiral. I'm so glad we've finally been brought to someone in charge.
Can we straighten out this difficulty?
We have done nothing wrong.
Beside the droid, the Celestian captain pushed on the tight skin cap covering his sloping head.
He jabbered away with a monotonous, blub blub blub.
The droid translated, Captain Tanun Badu demands an explanation.
The Celestian babbled in alarm and clutched the platinum arm of the droid.
Correction, the captain respectfully requests that you be so kind as to explain your actions.
Please tell us if there is anything he can do to avoid a diplomatic incident, as he has no wish to initiate any conflict.
The Celestian captain nodded vigorously.
A froth of saliva collected on his lips and ran in runnels between his flappy jowls.
Wipe your chin, Daala said.
She looked at the horrendous interrogation chair strapped in the shadows of the room.
The walls were covered with unfinished iron plates, held in place by large blocky bolts.
Stains marked various places that had not been cleaned after earlier interrogations.
The chair itself had angled pipes and tubing,
restraints, chains, spikes, most of which serve no purpose other than to increase a victim's terror. "What we would like from the captain right now," Daala said, turning back as if ignoring the chair, "is some information. Perhaps you can provide it to us without our needing to resort to any unpleasantness." The captain flinched in terror. The platinum female droid shifted from foot to foot and then seemed to reach a decision. The droid looked with apparent adoration at the Celestian captain and then straightened herself and spoke in a clear, unfluttered voice. "Admiral, I can provide that information. There is no need for you to torture my captain." The Celestian blub blub blubbed again, but the droid seemed not to hear. "We are on a mission to provide supplies and new living units for a small colony on the planet Dantooine. The colony is not affiliated with the rebellion as of this moment. The colonists are harmless refugees." "How many are in this colony?" Daala asked. "Approximately 50, taken from the old mining outpost Eol Shah. They are not presently armed." "I see," Daala said. "Well, Captain, we must liberate your assets. I believe that the cargo hold of a Corellian corvette routinely carries provisions for up to a year without restocking. I am commandeering those provisions for the service of the Empire. This colony on Dantooine will have to get their supplies some other way." The Celestian chittered in dismay, and Daala skewered him with a glare. "Perhaps, Captain, you would like to step outside the airlock and file a complaint?" The Celestian shut up instantly. The door of the interrogation chamber sighed open again, revealing two stormtrooper guards and Commander Kratos. "Take the captain and his droid back to his ship," Daala said, then cocked her head down to stare at the Celestian. "Our crew is already emptying your cargo holds, but General Odosk has set his men to repairing and bypassing the damaged engine. Enough that you could limp to another system." The Celestian bowed, speaking non-stop in his rodent-like language. The female droid stood at attention and spoke in an astonished voice.
"Why thank you, Admiral. That is most respectful of you. We appreciate your hospitality."
The stormtroopers took them away, clomping down the sterile halls of the Star Destroyer. The doors sealed shut again, leaving Daala alone with Commander Kratos. He turned to her with wide dark eyes below his beetling brows.
"Admiral, have we lowered ourselves to the level of space pirates? Attacking transport ships and stealing supplies?"
Daala removed a datapad from her hip and punched a button to call up her latest readout. She turned it toward him so he could look at the information.
"I appreciate your respect for the honor of the Imperial Navy, Commander. However, before I came to see the captives, I received a report regarding the contents of the corvette's cargo hold. There are indeed supplies for a new colony, but we also found heavy weaponry, communications gear, and prefabricated equipment for starfighter hangars."
She gestured toward the door.
"Back to the bridge. I want to see what happens next."
"What do you mean?"
Kratos said.
Daala switched off the datapad and looked at him.
"You'll see. Be patient for now."
As they left, the door of the interrogation chamber slid shut, sealing behind it the darkness and the smell of fear trapped in the room.
The close-up image of General Odosk flickered, but she could see the self-satisfied grin on his wide, swarthy face.
"Mission accomplished, Admiral."
"Excellent, General. I trust you are at a good vantage point."
Odosk nodded.
"I wouldn't miss it.
Thank you."
Daala turned back to the viewing window on the bridge. The wounded Corellian corvette dropped out of the Gorgon's hangar bay and drifted free in space.
"Back away," she told the navigator.
"Order the Basilisk and the Manticore to do the same."
"Yes, Admiral."
The three Star Destroyers spread out and moved away from the much smaller ship. The corvette's damaged rocket engine no longer glowed.
Kratos shook his head.
"I still can't believe you're letting him go."
Daala intentionally spoke loud enough for the rest of the bridge crew to hear. She rarely felt the need to explain her orders to underlings, but at certain times explaining her reasoning might make them respect her even more. Ships vanish all the time, Commander, Daala said. If we simply destroyed this ship, it could be written off as some accident in transportation. A meteor storm, a breached reactor plate, bad navigation through hyperspace. But if we let this captain send a message first, then the Rebel Alliance will know what we have done. We can accomplish the same task, but increase the terror and chaos. Do you agree? Kratos nodded, but he still looked doubtful. The comm officer spoke up. The transponder we implanted in his comm system has activated. He's sending a tight beam transmission to specific coordinates. Daala smiled. Good, I didn't think he'd wait until he got clear. The comm officer pressed an ear jack to the side of his head. He's reporting the situation, Admiral. Three Star Destroyers, fired upon without warning, taken prisoner and interrogated. I think that's enough, Daala said. She opened the comm channel. General Odosk, proceed. She shielded her eyes. The thermal detonators planted against the reactor walls of the 12 rocket pods detonated simultaneously, blasting the inferno open and sending a tidal wave of deadly radiation through the Corellian ship. An instant later the raging heat evaporated the entire hull, turning it into metallic steam. The rocket pods blew up in brilliant sunbursts, then the rest of the ship expanded outward in a blinding glare. Daala nodded. I think the survivors of the Hydra have had their revenge. In stunned admiration Kratos smiled. I believe so, Admiral. She turned to face the rest of her bridge crew. We now have accurate maps and information on the political situation of the Rebel Alliance. We have struck our first blow, the first of many. Daala drew a deep breath, feeling vibrant and alive with euphoria. Grand Moff Tarkin would have been proud of her. Our next stop will be the planet Dantooine, she said. We have a colony to visit. Chapter 5. Luke Skywalker, Jedi Master, gathered his 12 students in the Grand Audience Chamber of the Masasi Temple. Diffuse orange light trickled through the narrow skylights. Lush vines climbed the stone walls, spreading out in verdant webs in the corners. Most of the flat stones were a non-reflective smoky gray, other lozenges of dark green and vermilion and ochre stone ornamented the enormous chamber. Luke remembered standing here as a young man after their brief victory celebration following the destruction of the Death Star. He smiled as he recalled how Princess Leia had presented medals to him and Han Solo and Chewbacca. Now the Grand Audience Chamber stood empty except for Luke and his small group of Jedi candidates. Luke watched the students file toward him along the broad promenade. Wearing dark brown Jedi robes, the candidates walked in eerie silence across the slick floor that had long ago been polished smooth by the mysterious Masasi. Streen and Gantoris moved first, side by side. Gantoris looked full of self-importance. Of all those Luke had gathered at his Jedi training center, Gantoris had so far shown the most progress, the most inner strength, yet the man from Eol Shah did not seem to realize that he stood at a crossroads. Gantoris would soon need to decide exactly how he would proceed in his growth with the Force. Behind the two of them came Karana T, one of the young and powerful witches of Dathomir, who had left the other Force-wielding, Rancor-riding women on her homeworld to learn better control. Karana T and the other witches had been instrumental in helping him recover an ancient wrecked space station, the Chuanthor, in which resided many records of old Jedi training, records that Luke had studied to develop exercises for his Jedi trainees. Beside Karana T came Dorsk 81, a bald green and yellow-skinned humanoid from a world where all family units were genetically identical, cloned and raised to carry on the status quo. But Dorsk 81, the 81st reincarnation of the same genetic attributes, had somehow been dramatically changed. Though he seemed identical in every way, his mind worked differently, his thoughts moved along different paths, and he could feel the Force working through him. With the hope of becoming a Jedi Knight, Dorsk 81 had left his homeworld of identical people for something new. Then came Cam Solasar, an older man, son of a Jedi that Vader had slaughtered long ago. Solosar had fled the Empire after the Great Jedi Purge and had spent decades in isolation beyond the inhabited star systems. Upon returning, Solosar had been captured and tortured by evil Jedi, twisted to the dark side of the Force, but Luke had bested him in the game of lightsaber. Solosar had received advanced training in certain areas, but because of his self-imposed exile, he still knew little about many aspects of the Force. As the rest of the candidates gathered at the raised platform, Luke shrugged back his hood and tried to mask his pride at seeing the group. If he successfully completed their training, these candidates would form the core of a new order of Jedi Knights, champions of the Force, to help protect the New Republic against dark times. He heard them stirring, not speaking to each other, each one no doubt wrapped up in thoughts of touching the Force, finding new pathways to inner strength and windows to the universe that only Jedi teachings could open for them. Their collective talent amazed him, but he hoped for even more trainees. Soon Han Solo would send his young friend, Kip Duran, and Luke had strongly hinted for his former opponent Mara Jade to join them, since they had struck an uneasy truce during the battle against Joris Sabayoth. At the podium Luke tried to stand tall. He found the core of peace inside him that allowed him to speak with a firm voice. "I have brought you here to study and to learn, but I myself am still learning. Every living thing must continue to learn until it dies. Those who cease to learn, die that much sooner. Perhaps it was misleading when I called this an Academy for Jedi. Though I will teach you everything I know, I don't want you merely to listen to me lecture. Your training will be a landscape of self-discovery. Learn new things and share what you have learned with others. I will call this place Apraxium." This word, made up of ancient roots, was first used by the Jedi scholar Karina, distilling the concepts of learning combined with action. Our Apraxium, then, is a place for the learning of action. A Jedi is aware, but he does not waste time in mindless contemplation. When action is required, a Jedi acts. Luke repositioned a small translucent cube on the raised dais behind him. He ran his fingers over the cool surface of the ancient knowledge repository Leia had stolen from the resurrected Emperor. The Jedi Holocron. "We will invoke a past Jedi Master from the Holocron," Luke said. "We have used this device to learn the ways of the old Jedi Knights. Let us see what stories it has for us this morning." He activated the precious artifact. In the distant past it had been traditional for each Jedi Master to compile his life's knowledge and store it within a great repository such as this, which was then passed to one of his students. Luke had only begun to fathom its depths. An image formed both inside and outside the cube, a half-tangible projection that was more than just a stored bit of data, it was an interactive representation of the Jedi Master, a stubby alien, part insectal, part crustacean. It seemed to be bent with age or too much gravity. Its head extended into a long funnel, like a beak from which dangled whiskery protuberances. Close-set, glassy eyes stared like glittering pinpoints of knowledge. The creature leaned on a long wooden staff, its legs spindly and knobby as it swiveled its funnel-like face to contemplate the new audience. Tattered rags covered its body, sticking out in odd directions like clothing or external skin. Its voice came out in a reedy melody, like high-pitched music played under fast-running water. "I am Master Vodo Syusk Bass." "Master Vodo," Luke said, "I am Master Skywalker, and these are my apprentices. You have seen many things and recorded many thoughts. We'd be honored if you would tell us something we should know." The image of Master Vodo Syusk Bass hung his beak-like head on a jointed elbow of neck, as if in contemplation. Luke knew that the Holocron was simply uploading and sifting through reams of data, choosing an appropriate story through a personality algorithm stored with the Jedi Master's image. "I must tell you of the great Sith War that occurred." Here the image paused as the Holocron assessed the current situation. "4,000 years before your time. This war was caused by a student of mine, Exar Kun, who found forbidden teachings of the ancient Sith. He imitated the ways of the long-fallen Sith and used them to form his own philosophy of the Jedi Code, a distortion of all we know to be true and right. With this knowledge, Exar Kun established a vast and powerful brotherhood and claimed the title of the first Dark Lord of the Sith. Luke stiffened. Others have claimed that title, he said, even to this time. Including Darth Vader. Master Vodo Syask Bass seemed to lean more heavily on his walking stick. I had hoped Exar Kun and his kind were defeated once and for all. Exar Kun joined forces with another powerful Jedi and great warlord, Ulic Keldroma. Exar Kun worked his invisible threads into the fabric of the Old Republic, bringing downfall through treachery and his distorted abilities with the Force. Master Vodo looked at the gathered students. Gantoris seemed incredibly eager to hear more, leaning forward and staring with wide, dark eyes. The image of the long-dead Jedi Master turned to face Luke. You must warn your students to beware of the temptations of conquest. That is all I can tell you for now. The image flickered and wavered. With a feeling of deep uneasiness, Luke silenced the holocron. The images returned to swirling pearlescence inside its cubicle walls. I think that's enough for this morning, Luke said. We all know that other Jedi have followed the wrong path, bringing not only themselves but millions of innocent lives to doom and suffering. But I trust you. A Jedi must trust himself, and a Jedi Master must trust his apprentices. Explore yourselves and your surroundings, in teams or alone, whichever makes you comfortable. Go to the jungle. Go to other parts of this temple. Or simply go back to your chambers. The choice is yours. Luke sat down on the edge of the raised stage and watched the students file out of the grand hall. The translucent cube of the holocron stood mute beside him, a vessel filled with valuable but dangerous knowledge. Obi-Wan Kenobi had been Luke's teacher. Luke had listened to every word the old man had said, trusting it, yet Luke had later learned how often Obi-Wan had obscured the facts, had distorted information, or as Obi-Wan explained it, simply offered the truth, from a certain point of view. Luke watched the robed forms and wondered if his students could handle the knowledge they might discover. What if, like ancient Exar Kun in Master Vodo's story, they were tempted to uncover the forbidden teachings of the Sith, that so subtly yet crucially differed from the Jedi Code? Luke feared what might happen should one of his students travel down the wrong path. But he also knew that he had to trust them, or they could never become Jedi Knights. Deep into the night, Gantoris hunched over the cluttered worktable, secretly constructing his own lightsaber. A blanket of shadows surrounded him, obliterating distractions that might keep him from his task. His dark eyes had adjusted to the tight beam glow lamp that spilled a harsh pool of light over his debris-strewn work surface, leaving the rest of the room in murk. As Gantoris moved to pick up another precision tool, his shadow flapped like a bird of prey across the ancient stone walls. The great temple sat silent, like an ancient trap to stifle sound. The other students in Master Skywalker's Jedi Academy, his Praxium, as he called it, had retired to their private chambers to fall into an exhausted sleep or to meditate on Jedi relaxing techniques. Gantoris's neck ached, and his shoulder muscles burned from holding his cramped position for hours. He breathed in and out, smelling the thickness of old smoke and the scratchy moss that had worked for millennia to pry through cracks in the precisely placed temple blocks. The moss had withered not long after Gantoris had taken up residence in the chambers. Outside, the jungle of Yavin 4 simmered with restless life, rustling, chittering, singing, and shrieking, as stronger creatures fed, as weaker creatures died. Gantoris continued to work. He no longer needed sleep. He could draw the energy he required using different methods, secrets he had been taught that the other students did not suspect. His unbraided black hair stuck out in wiry shocks, and an acrid, gunpowdery smell clung to his cloak, his skin. He focused on the components scattered across the table: silver electronics, dull metal, glinting glass. He slid his fingertips across the cold bits of wire, picked up a sharp-edged microcontrol box with trembling hands. Widening his eyes in annoyance, Gantoris stared at his hands until the trembling stopped, then set to work again. He understood how the pieces would all fit together. Once he knew, once he had drawn together sufficient Jedi knowledge, everything seemed obvious to him.
Obvious.
The elegant energy blade served as the personal weapon of the Jedi, a symbol of authority, skill, and honor. Cruder weapons could cause more random destruction, but no other artifact evoked as much legend and mystery as the lightsaber.
Gantoris would settle for nothing else.
Every Jedi built his own lightsaber. It was a rite of passage in the training of a new student. Master Skywalker had not yet begun to teach him, though Gantoris had waited and waited. He knew he was the best of the students, and he chose not to wait any longer. Master Skywalker did not know everything a true Jedi Master must teach new apprentices. Skywalker had gaps in his knowledge, blank spaces he either did not understand or did not wish to teach. But Master Skywalker was not the only source of Jedi knowledge. Once he had forsaken sleep, Gantoris had taken to roaming the halls of the Great Temple, sliding barefoot and in silence along the cold floors that seemed to drink heat, no matter how warm the jungle had become during the day. Sometimes he wandered out into the rain forest at night, surrounded by mists and singing insects. The dew splashed his feet, his robe, making indecipherable patterns across his body like coded messages. Gantoris walked unarmed, silently daring any predator to challenge him, knowing that his Jedi skills would be proof against mere claws and fangs, but nothing molested him, and only once did he hear a large beast charging away from him through the underbrush. But the dark and mysterious voice that came to him in his nightmares had given him instructions on how to build a lightsaber. Gantoris had been driven with a new purpose. A true Jedi was resourceful. A true Jedi could make do. A true Jedi found what he needed. Using his ability to manipulate simple objects, he had broken past the seals into the locked rebel control rooms in the temple's lower levels. Banks of machinery, computers, landing grid panels, and automated defense systems sat covered with grime from a decade of abandonment. Master Skywalker had repaired little of the equipment. Jedi apprentices had no need for most of it. Quietly and alone, Gantoris had removed access panels, stripped out microcomponents, focusing lenses, laser diodes, and a cylindrical casing 27 centimeters long. It had taken him 3 nights, tearing apart the silent equipment, stirring up dust and spores, sending rodents and arachnids scurrying to safety. But Gantoris had found what he needed. Now he assembled the pieces. Under the garish light, Gantoris picked up the cylindrical casing. He used a spot laser welder to cut notches for the control switches. Each Jedi built his own lightsaber to a range of specifications and personal preferences. Some included safety switches that shut off the glowing blade if the handle was released, while other weapons could be locked on. Gantoris had a few ideas of his own. He installed a small but efficient power cell. It snapped into place, connecting precisely. Gantoris sighed, concentrated a moment to still his trembling hands again, then picked up another set of delicate wires. He flinched, whirling to look behind him in the shadows. He thought he had heard someone breathing, the rustle of dark garments. Gantoris stared with his red-rimmed eyes, trying to discern a dim human form in the corner.
"Speak, if you're there," Gantoris cried. His voice sounded harsh, as if he had swallowed burning coals.
When the shadows did not answer him, he sighed with cool relief. His mouth tasted dry, and soreness worked its way through his throat. But he willed away the feeling. He could drink water in the morning. A Jedi endured. Building the lightsaber was his personal test. He had to do it alone. Next, he took out the most precious piece of the weapon. 3 Karuska jewels, cast out from the high-pressure hell of the gas giant Yavin's core. When he and his addle-brained companion Streen had discovered the new Masasi temple far out in the jungle, Gantoris had found these gems on the steep obsidian walls. Embedded among the hypnotic pictographs etched into the black volcanic glass, the jewels had glinted in the hazy orange daylight. Though they had remained untouched for thousands of years, these 3 gems had flaked off as Gantoris stared at them. They fell to his feet in the crushed lava rock surrounding the lost temple. Gantoris had picked up the gems, cupping the warm crystals in his hands as Streen wandered among the obelisks, chattering to himself. Now Gantoris removed the jewels, one watery pink, another deep red, and the third starkly transparent with an inner electric blue fire along the edges of the facets. He was meant to have these jewels, they were destined for his own lightsaber. He knew that now. He understood all of his former nightmares, his former fears. Most lightsabers had only a single jewel that focused the pure energy from the power cell into a tight beam. By adding more than one gem, Gantoris's blade would have unexpected capabilities to surprise Master Skywalker. Finally, his fingers raw and aching, Gantoris sat up. Pain embroidered firelines across his neck, shoulders, and back, but he washed it away with a simple Jedi exercise. Outside the great temple he could hear the changing symphony of jungle sounds as nocturnal creatures found their dens, and daylight animals began to stir. Gantoris held the cylindrical handle of his lightsaber and inspected it under the glow lamp's unforgiving light. Craftsmanship was everything in a weapon like this. A barely noticeable variance could cause a disastrous blunder. But Gantoris had done everything right. He had taken no shortcuts, allowed no sloppiness. His weapon was perfect. He pushed the activator button. With a snap hiss, the awesome blade thrummed and pulsed like a living creature. The chain of three jewels gave the energy blade a pale purplish hue, white at the core, amethyst at the fringes, with rainbow colors rippling up and down the beam. Accustomed to the dimness, Gantoris squeezed his eyes to block out the glare, then gradually opened them again, staring in amazement at what he had made. He moved the blade, and the air crackled around him. The hum sounded like thunder, but none of the other students would hear it through the mammoth thickness of the stone walls. In his grip the blade felt like a winged serpent, sending the sharp scent of ozone curling to his nose. He slashed back and forth. The lightsaber became a part of him, an extension of his arm connected through the force to strike down any enemy. He sensed no heat from the vibrating blade, only a cold annihilating fire. He deactivated the blade, awash in euphoria, and carefully hid the completed lightsaber under his sleeping pallet. "Now Master Skywalker will see I am a true Jedi," he said to the shadows along the walls. But no one answered him. Chapter 6. The private investigatory proceedings of the New Republic's ruling council stood closed against Admiral Ackbar. He waited in the anteroom outside, staring at the tall steelstone door as if it were a wall, blocking the end of his life. He stared unblinking at the designs and scrollwork modeled by the Emperor Palpatine after ancient Sith hieroglyphics, and they disturbed him. Ackbar sat on the cold synthetic stone bench, feeling only his misery, despair, and failure. He nursed his bandaged left arm and felt pain slice up and down his biceps where tiny needles held the slashed salmon-colored skin together. Ackbar had refused standard treatment by medical droid or healing in a Bacta tank programmed for Calamarian physiology. He preferred to let the painful recuperation remind him of the destruction he had caused on Vortex. He cocked his enormous head, listening to the rise and fall of heated voices through the closed door. He could make out only a mingled murmur of mixed voices, some strident, some insistent. He looked down and self-consciously brushed at his clean white admiral's uniform. His remaining injuries seemed insignificant compared to the pain inside him. In his mind he kept seeing the crystalline cathedral of winds shatter around him in an avalanche of shards, hurling a storm of glassy daggers in all directions. He saw the bodies of winged vores tumbling around him, slaughtered by the razor-edged crystal sabers. Ackbar had ejected Leia to safety, but he wished he had been brave enough to switch off the crash field, because he did not want to live with such disgrace. Ackbar had been piloting the deadly ship, no one else. He had crashed into the precious Cathedral of Winds. No one else. He looked up at the sound of shuffling footsteps and saw another Calamarian approaching tentatively down the rose-hued corridors. The other ducked his head, but swiveled his great fish eyes up to look at his admiral. "Turpfen," Ackbar said. His voice sounded listless, like words dropped onto the polished floor, but he tried to dredge up enthusiasm. You've come after all. I could never desert you, Admiral. The Calamarian crewmen remain your firm supporters, even after.
Ackbar nodded, knowing the unshakable loyalty of his chief starship mechanic.
As with many of his people, Terpfen had been taken away from his watery homeworld, kidnapped by Imperial enslavers, and forced to work on designing and refining their star destroyers with the renowned Calamarian starship building expertise. But Terpfen had attempted sabotage and had been tortured.
Severely.
The scars still showed on his battered head. During the Imperial occupation of the planet Calamari, Ackbar himself had been pressed into service as a reluctant aide to Moff Tarkin. He had served Tarkin for several years until he finally escaped during a rebel attack.
Have you completed your investigation?
Ackbar asked.
Have you gone over the records that survived the crash?
Terpfen turned his head away. He clasped his broad flipper hands together. His skin flushed with splotches of bright maroon, showing his embarrassment and shame.
I have already filed my report with the New Republic Council.
He looked meaningfully at the closed door of the chamber.
I suspect they are discussing it even now.
Ackbar felt as if he had just attempted to swim under an ice floe.
And what did you find? He said in a firm voice, trying to resurrect the power of command.
I found no indication of mechanical failure, Admiral.
I've gone over the crash tapes again and again, and I have simulated the flight path through the recorded wind patterns on Vortex.
I continue to come up with the same answer.
Nothing was wrong with your ship.
He looked up at the Admiral, then turned away again.
Ackbar could tell that this report was as difficult for Terpfen to say as it was for Ackbar to hear.
I checked your ship myself before you took off for Vortex.
I found no indications of mechanical instabilities.
I suppose I could have missed something.
Ackbar shook his head.
Not you, Terpfen.
I know your work too well.
Terpfen continued in a quieter voice.
I can reach only one conclusion from the data, Admiral.
But Terpfen's voice cut off, as if he refused to speak the inevitable.
Ackbar did it for him.
Pilot error, he said.
I caused the crash.
It's my fault.
I've known it all along.
Terpfen stood, his head hung so low that he showed only the bulging, sack-like dome of his cranium.
I wish there was some way I could prove otherwise, Admiral.
Ackbar extended a flipper hand and placed it on Terpfen's gray crewman's uniform.
I know you've done your best.
Now please do me one more favor.
Outfit another B-wing for my personal use and provision it for a long journey.
I'll be flying alone.
Someone might object to having you fly again, Admiral, Terpfen said, but don't worry.
I can find some way around the problem.
Where will you be going?
Home, Ackbar answered, after I tend to some unfinished business.
Terpfen saluted smartly.
Your ship will be waiting for you, sir.
Ackbar felt a hard knot in his chest as he returned the salute.
He stepped forward to the closed steelstone door and pounded on the ornate surface, demanding to be let in.
The heavy door groaned open on automatic hinges.
Ackbar stood at the threshold as the members of the ruling council turned to look at him.
The flowstone seats were sculpted and polished to a high luster, including the empty chair that still bore his own name.
The air was too dry for his nostrils and stank with the underlying dusty smell of a museum.
He could detect the pungent nervous odor of human sweat mixed with the peppery steam from their chosen hot drinks and refreshments.
Obese Senator Hreckenthorm waved a pudgy hand at Ackbar.
Why don't we make him lead the reparations team?
That seems appropriate to me.
I wouldn't think the Vors want him anywhere near their planet, Senator Beliblis said.
The Vors haven't asked us to help them rebuild at all, Leia Organa Solo said, but that doesn't mean we should ignore it.
We're lucky the Vors are not as emotional as other races.
This is already a terrible tragedy, but it does not seem likely it will turn into a galactic incident, Mon Mothma said.
Gripping the edge of the table, she stood and finally acknowledged Ackbar's presence.
Her skin looked pale, her face gaunt, her eyes and cheeks sunken. She had skipped many important meetings lately. Ackbar wondered if the vortex tragedy had worsened her health.
"Admiral," Mon Mothma said, "these proceedings are closed. We will summon you after we have taken a vote."
Her voice seemed stern and cracking, devoid of the compassion that had launched her career in galactic politics.
Minister of State Leia Organa Solo looked at him with her dark eyes. A flood of sympathy crossed her face, but Ackbar turned away with a stab of anger and embarrassment. He knew Leia would argue his case most strongly, and he expected support from General Rekan and General Dodonna, but he did not know how Senators Garm Beliblis, Crekenthorn, or even Mon Mothma herself would vote.
"That doesn't matter," Ackbar thought. He would remove their need to decide, remove the possibility of further humiliation.
"Perhaps I can make these deliberations easier on all of us," Ackbar said.
"What do you mean, Admiral?"
Mon Mothma said, frowning at him. Her face was seamed with deep lines.
Leia half rose as she suddenly understood.
"Don't."
Ackbar made a decisive gesture with his left fin hand, and Leia reluctantly sat down again. He touched the left breast on his pristine white uniform, fumbling with the catch as he removed his admiral's rank insignia.
"I have caused enormous pain and suffering to the people of Vortex. I have brought immense embarrassment to the New Republic, and I have called down terrible shame upon myself. I hereby resign as commander of the New Republic fleet, effective immediately. I regret the circumstances of my departure, but I am proud of the years I have served the Alliance. I only wish I could have done more."
He placed his insignia on the creamy alabaster shelf in front of the empty council seat that had once been his own. In shocked silence, the other council members stared at him like a mute tribunal. Before they could voice their mandatory, and probably insincere, objections, Ackbar turned and strode out of the room, walking as tall as he dared, yet feeling crushed and insignificant. He went back toward his quarters to pack his most prized possessions before heading to the hangar bay, where he would take the ship Terpfen had promised him. He had one place to visit first, and then he would return to his homeworld of Calamari. If General Obi-Wan Kenobi could vanish into obscurity on a desert planet like Tatooine, Ackbar could do the same, and live out the rest of his life among the lush sea tree forests under the seas. With the pretense of taking out a B-wing fighter to test its response under extreme stress, Terpfen soared away from Coruscant. The other distraught Calamarian crewmen wished him luck before he departed, assuming he intended to continue his desperate work to clear Admiral Ackbar's name. But just before the jump into hyperspace, Terpfen entered a new series of coordinates into the navicomputer. The B-wing lurched with a blast of hyperdrive engines. Starlines appeared around him, and the ship snapped into the frenzied, incomprehensible swirl of hyperspace. He reflexively slid the nictitating membrane over his glassy eyes. Terpfen felt shudders pass through his body as he strained to resist the calling. But he knew by now, after all these years, that he could do nothing to fight it. Screaming nightmares never let him forget his ordeal in the hellish conditioning on the Imperial military training planet of Kerida. The scars on his battered head were not just from torture, but from Imperial vivisection, where the doctors had sawed open his skull and scooped out portions of his brain, segments that controlled a Calamarian's loyalty, his volition, and his resistance to special commands. The cruel xenosurgeons had replaced the missing areas of Terpfen's brain with specially grown organic circuits that mimicked the size, shape, and composition of the removed tissue. The organic circuits were perfectly camouflaged and could resist the most penetrating medical scan, but they made him a helpless cyborg, a perfect spy and saboteur who could not think for himself when the Imperials wanted him to think their thoughts. The circuits left him sufficient mental capacity to play his part, to make his own excuses each time the Imperials summoned him. After guiding his ship for several standard time units, Terpfen looked at the chronometer. At the precise instant indicated, he pulled the levers that switched off the hyperdrive motors and kicked in the sublight engines. His ship hung near the lacy veil of the Kron Drift, the gaseous remnants of a multiple supernova where four stars had simultaneously erupted some 4 millennia ago. The wisps of gas crackled with pinks, greens, and searing white. The residual X-rays and gamma radiation from the old supernova caused static over his comm system, but it would also mask this meeting from prying eyes. A dark Caridan ship already hung there waiting for him. With a flat stealth coating on its hull, the Caridan ship looked like a matte black insect that swallowed starlight, leaving only a jagged silhouette against the starfield. Protrusions of assault blasters and sensor antennas stuck out like spines. A burst of static came across Turkfen's comm system, then the tight beam holotransmission of Ambassador Fergan's head focused itself inside the B-wing cockpit. "Well, my little fish," Fergan said. His huge eyebrows looked like black feathers curling up on his forehead. "What is your report? Explain why our two victims were not killed in the crash you engineered." Turkfen tried to stop the words from coming, but the organic circuits kicked in, providing all the answer the Imperial Ambassador needed. "I sabotaged Ackbar's personal ship, and that should have meant death for both passengers, but even I underestimated Ackbar's skill as a pilot." Fergan scowled. "So the mission failed?" "On the contrary," Turkfen said, "I believe it is even more successful. The New Republic is far more affected by this chain of events than it would be if a simple crash had killed the Minister of State and the Admiral. Their fleet commander has now resigned in disgrace, and the ruling council is left without an obvious replacement." Fergan considered for a moment, then nodded as a slow smile spread across his fat, dark lips. He changed the subject. "Have you made any progress in uncovering the location of the third Jedi baby?" During his torturous conditioning, Turkfen had spent 4 weeks with his head entirely encased in a solid plasteel helmet that kept him blinded, sent jabs of pain at random and malicious intervals. He could not speak or drink or eat, fed entirely through intravenous nutritional supplements. Now, as he sat trapped inside the cockpit of the B-wing fighter, he felt swallowed up in that black pit again. Turkfen answered in a steady, uninflected voice. "I have told you before, Ambassador. Anakin Solo is being held on a secret planet, the location of which is known only to a very few, including Admiral Ackbar and the Jedi Master Luke Skywalker. I think it highly unlikely that Ackbar will divulge it in casual conversation." Fergan looked as if he had just bit into something sour and wanted to spit it out. "Then what good are you?" Turkfen would have taken no offense even if his organic circuitry had allowed him to. "I have set into motion another plan that may provide the information you seek." Turkfen had performed the task with parts of his mind he did not own. Flipperhands moving not of his own volition had completed what the rest of him wanted to scream against. "Your plan had better work," Fergan said. "And one last question, I've noticed that Mon Mothma has avoided public appearances for several weeks. She has not attended many important meetings, sending proxies instead. Tell me, how is dear Mon Mothma's health?" He began to chuckle. "Failing," Turkfen said, cursing himself. The laughter in Fergan's face suddenly vanished, and his holographic eyes stared into Turkfen's great watery disks. "Go back to Coruscant, my little fish, before they notice you've disappeared. We wouldn't want to lose you, when there is so much work left to do." Fergan's transmission winked out. A moment later the beetle-like ship turned and, with a blue-white flare of its hyperdrive engines, burst into a fold of space and vanished. Turkfen hung alone in the darkness, looking out at the glowing slash of the Kron drift, surrounded by the echoing walls, of his own betrayal. End of Part 1. This book will be released in segments each week on our YouTube channel, free of charge. However, to help support the costs involved in creating this audiobook, the entire book is available now to our Patreon supporters. If you would like to listen to this entire book early, please visit patreon.com/yjkaudiobooks. The link is also available in the video description below. Thank you for listening, and may the Force be with you, always.